Good evening. I would like to open the Deerfield Planning Board April 18th, 2017 at about 7:10 here at the town offices at South Deerfield Town Hall. The agenda tonight is call to order, review of minutes from March meeting, review mail, take any public comment, and then go over our old business. The first one is an A&R at 188 Mill Village Road. The second one is deliberation on subdivision plan and stormwater plan for the condominiums at Sugarloaf. C, signed decision paperwork for Cumberland Farms and New England Patient Network. D, authorized disbursement of encumbered funds. The sixth item is any other business not reasonably anticipated 48 hours prior to the posting of this meeting. And then we set a date for the next meeting, and then we adjourn. Any changes to the agenda? Can we put mail at the end? We often do that. I think we should actually
just say that.
Say it at the end. Review of minutes. I believe we do not have minutes from the March meeting.
Didn't we do that the last meeting?
No, the last meeting.
Yeah, the beginning of April.
Actually, we did the
ones that
we did the March meetings. We don't have the April 3rd
have
meeting.
The April ones, right?
The first meeting in April meeting. Yes.
So it's not March. It's
so that's a correction to the agenda. This should have been a review of the April 3rd, and we do not have that.
They're half done, but they're not all.
Several of the items that came up during that meeting will come up again tonight, so I think we're okay on that. We'll repeat what we need to. Any public comments? So at the beginning of these meetings, we try to take a 2 or 3 minutes. If there's something that's not on the agenda that a resident of Deerfield wants us to know about, this would be the time to do it. If it's on the agenda, then you wait till that point comes. Is there anything someone would like to mention that's not on the agenda?
Is there an opportunity to address the process of what's gone on here the last 8 months as far as the Sugarloaf condos?
All right, so the Sugarloaf condos is on the agenda tonight. So if you want to talk about that,
well, it's not public comment on the process of how, like in October 16th, they did a soil survey.
So you're talking, if you're going to talk about that project, we get to that. But if you have something,
but I'm just
your original
the process,
question,
I'm asking a question,
yeah.
John.
So your original
asking a question.
Yeah.
October 16th, they did a soil survey, 15 pits. Then they published.
Okay, I'm gonna cut you off here. Is it something that's not on tonight's agenda?
It's a point of order is what I'm asking.
But that will be on the agenda.
Yeah.
It will be on the agenda.
As long as I have an opportunity to address it, because it's totally wrong.
Well, your first question was, is there a time to address the process of the planning board? And certainly there is. We can get it on any agenda you'd like. So if you could call the town hall.
I called last time. They put me on the selectmen's meeting, okay?
That's good, too.
They put me on the selectmen's meeting.
All right.
If I have an issue with the way that...
If that didn't satisfy you, then we'd be happy to put it on the planning board.
I have an issue with the way the whole thing was done. Thank you.
So any other public comment, things that aren't on the agenda tonight? All right. Old business. So we had an A&R, 188 Mill Village Road, Barway Farm plan to combine two farms. We actually had it last month. We didn't get to it, and so it was approved by...
By default,
what do you call that? 21 days was up. The purpose of that plan was to combine current Deerfield Assessor's lots, map 94, lot 19, map 104, lot 2.
Did we actually have the paperwork on that the last meeting? Seems like we didn't even have all the paperwork.
There was a map here. They came and got it.
I think it's because they were moving a line rather than adding. I think
there was no representative.
And it was midnight.
And it was midnight.
So I have a
yeah,
on April 10th, there was a note. It says approval not required. Town clerk certificate. I hereby certify that no notice of decision was received on the A&R application submitted on March 13th, 2017, by Stephen Melnick to the planning board. The approval granting authority of the town of Deerfield by April 4th. In accordance with Mass General Law Chapter 40A, the A&R is deemed granted due to the failure of the planning board to take action within said 14 days. So That's that.
Does it say within 14 days?
I know, it says take action within set 14. We've always been going off the 21 day.
So you're still outside your 21 days.
Oh, yeah.
And they did not initial the area where it says they would give us more time. But anyway, I don't think any of us have any issues because it was taking two lots and making them into one.
So, would it be helpful if we were to review and sign it anyways, even though it's not going to matter? Okay, I didn't know if it would be better for the applicant, that's all.
And we don't even have it here, actually, so we don't have the Mylars.
What's that? The town, the planning board signed it?
The clerk, town clerk.
Yeah, so I'm saying we don't have to sign it.
So that was, I guess, more for informational purposes.
Okay, all right.
Next up is deliberation on subdivision plan and stormwater plan for the condominiums at Sugarloaf. I would invite the applicants to come up if they could. Pat, do you want to swing around and we'll take Roger's name off of there so that you can...
My chocolate.
Oh, did I sit in my right spot?
But it's a nice comfy chair.
Put it over here with Max's and let's...
Actually, as we're waiting for the applicants, could we, I'd like to make it clear that the Deerfield Planning Board does have a quorum tonight. We might just say who we are.
John Baronis.
Rachel Blaine.
John Wheat.
Kip Camosa.
Paul Alice.
And I'm Pat Smith from the Franklin Regional Council of Governments, serving as technical assistant to the board.
Thank you very much. We will all make an attempt to speak into our microphones for both people in the audience and people on our TV, which is the other reason why we have mics. And
we throw a shout out too to Chris Collins of FCAT, who went the extra mile to get us mic'd.
And who stays late.
And stays late.
Through these meetings.
Yes.
So we have had, we received an application on December 15th for a subdivision and stormwater plan entitled Condominiums at Sugarloaf. We held a public hearing on January 3rd, 2017, February 6th, 2017, March 6th, 2017, and April 3rd, 2017. At the April 3rd meeting, at all those public hearings, many residents were in attendance, which we appreciate, and we heard from any and all people who wanted to say something. We then closed the public hearing. So what that means is when the public hearing is closed, then we can no longer take input from the public. So tonight is the deliberation of the planning board, and I, as chair, would say that the planning board has done an excellent job of taking in information, trying to sort through it, what's the most important, and asking questions. The residents of Deerfield have been extremely helpful to us to raise items, raise issues that have significance to them, and we definitely thank them for doing so. So tonight, we're going to go through some of our findings and discuss some conditions before we make this decision. And I would ask that everybody sort of listen to these findings and conditions as we proceed. And as I said, unfortunately, once you close a public hearing, no new information is supposed to can come forward. There might be some times when we need to talk to the applicants and discuss some things with them. But one of the first things I just wanted to put out there was that we are under the subdivision control law. And so the planning board has certain restrictions on what kinds of things we can do and what we can't do. And that's how we're going to make our decision. And I just wanted to quote a couple things here, is that the subdivision control law, reading from the Commonwealth of Mass overview of the subdivision control law, it's a comprehensive statutory scheme designed for the safety, convenience, and welfare of the inhabitants of the cities and towns. It accomplishes this purpose by, among other things, regulating the laying out and construction of ways in subdivisions. So this is not about necessarily who's we don't decide what exactly is proposed. We take what applicants have and we look out for the safety, convenience, welfare of inhabitants. In particular, things that have to do with public ways and public utilities. planning board, just some other sort of things, and this is, we haven't done this for a long time, so I'm kind of going over this for the planning board as well as the public. Planning board regulations must be sufficiently clear so that landowners will know in advance what is or may be required. A planning board can consider the adequacy of a public way, providing access to a proposed subdivision, that we're doing here. And of course, there was the public hearing requirement, which we have fulfilled, and we have gone beyond the, we try to do these things within 90 days, but if there need to be continuation to make sure input is received, then we need to do that, and we have done that, and we appreciate everybody bearing with us for that. So I just want to put it out there that there's certain things that we can regulate, certain things we can't. But this is an application that came before us, so we reviewed it, and now we have some findings and conditions. Any questions by the planning board about our procedure? So what I'd like to do is, Pat Smith has given us their certificate of a proposed certificate of decision on definitive subplan, subdivision plan, and I'd like to know, it's several different items. We have findings and then conditions. Is that how it's laid out, Pat?
Yeah, it just goes through. So this, what we're looking at now is the certificate of decision on definitive subdivision plan. It's an updated draft 4/18/17. It shows all the track changes. So this was the original draft that I had prepared, and then it is, there are comments in here by John, which show in red, and town council has reviewed it and added a lot of comments. As you'll see, those show up in purple font, and then I added on page 2 and on page 4 a couple of comments that Sarah Campbell, the peer engineer, had submitted, and those show up in blue font. So you can tell who made what comments. And I have to apologize for my own purposes. I can barely read it in this ridiculously small font, but it comes out that way so that you can see town council's comments in the margin. So you can see where he's...
Now Sarah's stuff, you said, is in blue or shaded?
Hers in blue.
Or shaded blue.
It's in, it shows in blue under blue font and underline. So there's a little bit at the top of 4 and the middle of 2. I interspersed some of that with John's on
the
number.
What's the shading?
Those are all from council, and where it's shaded, that means his comment is associated with that shaded portion.
Can I just make a point of order? So the comments are only from the planning board chair and not from the board as a whole?
So it's only the planning board chair that I reviewed them in advance.
So this is a draft, and that's what we're going to deliberate on tonight.
Thank you. I'm just trying to understand the process.
I will also let you know that I had a lengthy discussion with the town, with our
council, as I did as well today.
Adam Costa, who was here last meeting but could not be here tonight, is available by phone if need be. He did tell me.
Yes, I have his cell phone number.
So what I'd like to go, so most of this that we're going to discuss all of it is things that have been discussed over the past 4 months. So there's about 22 items, and within there there's some A through G, so there's a lot of items.
Yeah.
I was thinking we could do it almost as we do at the town meeting, where we go through, and if there's something that we want to talk further about that seems to be like something we want to have a discussion, we say, hold. But a lot of them are very straightforward, I think, that we'll all be fine with. So I was wondering if that might be a way to get through it, because I'd like to know what are the major issues.
So you just want to find out where issues are and then go back
and then
discuss.
Come back. And the other reason for doing that is some of these, a condition later on might have something to do with an earlier condition. And I saw three that maybe actually could be merged or have to do with each other. So does that sound like a reasonable way to do it?
Sure.
We're asking Pat to take notes on this so that, because it is a lengthy thing, instead of having Paul try to make it into the minutes as a vote, that since it's already here and Pat can make the changes. So any changes that we make tonight then can get written up before anything gets signed. All right. So we start, so you've set this up in the form that's
This is a form that's based on a whole set of subdivision regulation forms that are appended to the orange subdivision regulations that were just revised in the last 2 years. Most council now advise towns to, when they update their regs, to have a full complement of forms attached to them, and Adam and I, town council, and I talked a little bit about that today. Ultimately, I know you guys have discussed potentially looking at your subdivision regs since they go to 2005, so you may want to go back and look at forms. So this is based on that with adaptations in order to get your information in here better, but that's where the form comes from, so it's an accepted format. It goes through just the basics of the plan, you know, the who's the applicant, the date, what's the date of the plan, what were the dates of the public hearings, and then when you get on page 2.
But I just actually, it's one thing that's not in here, and it actually probably comes under the very beginning, and I actually said it, that we received an application on December 15th.
That is the date of the plan, that is the original date, too. The plan is a...
Right.
So if you want to, we could put an application date as well if you'd like.
And the question is, and this is the question to the applicant.
That's where we stand.
Is are all the right signatures on there? So we have the developer, and we're wondering if the landowners are
on the original. Yeah, it was on the preliminary plan.
On the preliminary plan.
I believe the law provides that with a signed purchase and sale, that Mr. Whiteman is a designated agent of the land, which complies with the subdivision application, is my understanding.
We gave you a copy of the PNS showing that I have the right to proceed with the planning board at the will of the approval of the owners as well.
All right, so that's one thing we'll just go back and check. Yeah. Because it was, when I went back and looked at the actual application for the definitive plan, I noticed it wasn't, there weren't other signatures.
So that's how we've always done it, and okay. I've always done it with other towns as well, is that the...
And we have been discussing, ultimately, we may use an LLC for this project if it's approved. So I've been speaking with your town council about the signatures. So this issue came up in that discussion as well. And I won't speak for him, but I think we all felt the purchase and sale was the important document that named Mr. Whiteman as the agent for the property at this time, or as a party in control of it.
And specifically gave me the right to develop the property and do this, what we're doing tonight.
All right, so we'll go back and look
sure.
at that.
Yeah.
All right, so then we can go.
Okay, so we'll add that application date there. So that's a good idea, because that gives you the effective date from which everything tolls. So that's good to identify that. It identifies when the public hearings were. Board of Health approved the definitive plan as presented according to the letter that you read at the last meeting.
So there's a question if that needs to be on a more formal approval versus just a comment form. I think it was the comment form.
Yeah, I believe it was a comment form.
So
I guess that's a question also for council.
And
but
so
you did. They did have a comment on the definitive plan, correct? Because you had read that, I thought, at the last meeting.
I did. So I guess the other thing I want to make clear tonight is that we're going to double check everything that's done properly. The last thing we want is to have
what was the question on the table right
come
now?
Back.
Whether the Board of Health had approved the definitive plan, whether their notation on the comment form was sufficient unto meeting that requirement. So we'll look into that to make sure. And then we get to number 3, and this is where we start to get into the meat of what you guys are doing. This is where you begin to lay out the findings upon which you are basing your decision and the conditions that will be appended, which come later in this document. So these are items as drafted A through G, 3A through G. And if you want, I can just read through them one after the other, John. So
yes.
I will start with, three reads. The planning board, in its deliberations at an open meeting duly noticed and held on April 18, 2017, made the following findings. A, the proposed definitive subdivision plan for the condominiums at Sugarloaf is in the public interest and is not inconsistent with the intent and purpose of the subdivision control law. Anybody want to flag that for a later discussion? No. B, the soil evaluation data and summary from Daniel M. Nietzsche, SE, CPESC, CESSWI, C, Senior Environmental Scientist, GZA, Geo Environmental, Inc., dated January 16, 2017, includes adequate soil descriptions and establishes the depth to the seasonal high groundwater table to the extent necessary for purposes of designing the roadways and stormwater management systems for the proposed subdivision. Further discussion? No.
I want to see the where the tests were done. Is that the...
Okay, so we'll make note.
Yeah.
So that's Tony, you have that test pit...
That's a hold.
...document, so they could see that?
We actually perform more than just that, but it's in the stormwater management plan.
Yeah.
And that's where we would keep them.
Yeah.
And so it's an appendix to that report.
And is it on your any of the drawings?
Yeah, it's at, in the test pit locations are shown on the drawings.
Yeah, yeah, I just want to see that. Yeah.
Okay, so we made a note about that.
When do you want to see it, John?
Tonight. So we're going to go through
these. So that's a hold, then you're saying?
Yeah, well, it's a hold.
He's got a hold on that.
Because there might be several things, and then we'll ask.
Okay, that's what I was trying to get at.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. C, restricting sales within the condominium subdivision in perpetuity to purchasers with at least one resident aged 55 years old or older per unit, as proposed by the applicant, will limit the increase in traffic to 3-7% compared to 10% increase for a subdivision with no age restrictions, and will help meet the demand for housing for residents 55 years of age and older. Any further discussion on that?
No, I was just thinking, I might not have given clear guidelines. So the holds would be from the planning board or the applicant, because obviously we want the applicant to understand these very well. And so if there's any questions, please let us know.
Some. Yeah.
Okay.
So do you guys have any questions on any of these first A, B, or C as of yet? No. Okay. And does the planning board have anything on C?
No.
No. Okay.
Not me.
D. The proposed stormwater management system meets the requirements of the stormwater regulations for the town of Deerfield as adopted by the Planning Board / Stormwater Authority 04-04-2011, including the more rigorous standards for properties located within the Zone 2 Water Supply Protection Area for the South Deerfield Water Supply District. Any holds on anybody's part?
We have the documents here.
Okay, I'm not seeing any holds on that one. E. Allowing the 285-foot spacing of the intersections of the new access roads rather than the required 600-foot intersection spacing is acceptable to the town and is not inconsistent with spacing of other streets in town based on the geometry and current MDOT traffic counts on Sugarloaf Street and the site distance at the proposed intersection locations. In addition, two access roads to this subdivision is preferred by the town fire department. The fact that this subdivision has a 55-plus age restriction for residents also justifies locating the intersections closer together than would be otherwise acceptable because residents over 55 years old tend to have fewer vehicle trips than the general population in a classic subdivision unrestricted by age of residents would generate. There was a lot of working done on that, and it's still, frankly, as I'm reading it, a little awkward, but we're trying to get a lot in there.
Yeah.
So any further discussion on that one?
We went over that last month.
You're going to go with that? Okay. F, allowing catch basins to be located at more hydrologically appropriate locations rather than at the required intervals of not more than 300 feet would be in the best interest of the town and the project itself and is consistent with standard engineering practices. Based on proposed slopes, no water should be running on the surface for more than 300 feet. Any holds, comments on that?
Okay, so wait a minute, hold on a second.
I think the last sentence I'd like to strike.
You want to?
That that's necessary.
All right, so we'll put a hold with a question on that last sentence. Okay.
We'll put a hold on it.
And so we have a hold on F. Now G, iron rods or pins placed at internal lot corners in lieu of concrete or granite bounds will be adequate to define the legal dimensions of the lots, which will not be under separate ownership in the condominium project. Any further discussion needed on that one? No. And then I had H in there for people to add other findings. No one as of yet has suggested any other additional ones. Certainly the board would be in a position to do so if there are other things that you would like to add. But for now, the holds we have are on B, on the soil evaluation data, and F, the catch basins.
Yep.
So I know you want to go back to B?
Or not.
So that was the one where the board would like to review those, the test pit locations.
Actually, this is going to be a comeback when we talk about the conditions, so we can do that at the same time, so let's keep moving.
Okay, is everybody else happy? Does anybody else have any comments they want to make on that B finding? Okay, so we'll just sort of hold that, we may come back to that. F, they're allowing the catch basins, so Tony, you had a comment?
I just followed the language that was approved in the waiver request at the last meeting. That is an additional sentence that I don't think needs to be there, I think.
It was the...
Was waived would be the appropriate way to state those findings.
It was one of the reasons I believe the board accepted that waiver.
It's based on hydraulic conditions that I identified in calculations in the stormwater management report. Not the subdivision regulations, it's a rule of thumb, placing them at every 300 feet. We appropriately put those at strategic locations at the intersection and calculated the amount of flow that would go along the road to those catch basins is properly done. It's standard engineering conditions. So I can run it because I got a half a road. In some areas, I might run it slightly more than 300 feet, but it doesn't impact the road or deteriorate from it. The calculations are in their report and were reviewed. So that last sentence doesn't appear in the waiver. It was in our waiver request. And that's how we approached that at that last meeting. So I just don't want to have you put something in the findings that are not supported by the documents that were submitted to you and were reviewed.
Right, but what we want to have in the documents is things that on why, how we base some of our decisions.
Yeah.
So, and I'm going to refer to John, maybe Rachel. I remember we had a discussion that we thought the way the slopes of the roads were, that it made sense to have a catch basin over here and over here, even if they were further than 300 feet apart, because there was a high point in between.
Yeah, that was part of
it. Right, that's the way that I understood it also. You might have 500 feet between basins, but there was a high point in the middle, so that would be 250 versus 500.
No, that's not my response to the board last time, and my response is the calculations that were supported in that. What we do is we do spread calculations on the amount of flow in the street and the capture or capacity of the inlets, and that's how we a lot of times design those things, and I've done it numerous times. The calculations are in the report on how we do that. You just, because sometimes you could have 300 feet and you don't have a lot of flow that's getting to it, and it's a wasted place for a catch basin because it's very underutilized. Where we're putting them is where we're utilizing them the best. And if it were a problem, then we would have installed them up. And I can show you on the plans of where they're strategically located, where they make the most sense. Don't forget, on half of the road, you have a swale that runs around the whole outside.
Right.
So they're engineered design. They're not by a rule of thumb.
We heard you, and we appreciated it, but I was also, I guess...
The point of not having water in the street, that's the ultimate goal. So all we're saying is that in a sense, this gives us, it's going to happen, it's going to be fine, gives us an enforcement piece, too, to say this was the intention of this bylaw. It was waived because it does make sense the way it is, but let's just return to the intention of not having water in the street and that being a concern in development.
Well, the design of street drainage, I don't want to get into a class on how we design all of this, but you're going to have water running in the gutter,
okay? That's
the bigger the storm you have, the more spread of water away from the curb line out into the street. Mm-hmm. So what we want to do is in a heavy storm, we want to keep dry lane, and usually it's in the middle of the road, mm-hmm. and so that you don't have the entire. Now, that's not the case in a lot of areas. I mean, some agencies will allow you to flood between curbs in the road in a big storm. We haven't done that. We've designed it so that, and I show those calculations, I say what the spread is in the appropriate area. Sometimes, for instance, if you have a fairly steep road, you put a catch basin just because it's 300 feet on a steep road, it's not going to catch anything because the water's bypassing it. So it's better to locate those in strategic areas where you've got more capacity. Sumps, on grade, we have both conditions here. They're analyzed in the report. So I just want you to understand the process that we went through in designing and appropriately placing those at the correct locations where they get the most capture, and we still have the the spread that still makes clear for dry lanes to be able to drive in the road.
And we do, like in Section D, we say the proposed stormwater management system meets the requirements, so that wasn't so much the issue. Is that something you can show us, where the catch basins are, and like, is it just one or two that are, where the water's going to be running longer, or?
You didn't bring the plans? There should be some other ones here, right?
Is that diagrams in there?
John, what other type of language could we use?
Right, just to say.
For that, you know, I understand what Tony's saying, and I understand why we're doing what we're doing to, you know, protect the town.
The original suggestion was simply to remove that final sentence that was being added.
Right.
See if you feel
so, because I think John helped with this language that they're located at more hydrologically appropriate locations.
Right, that did come from the waiver. Yeah. I tried to mirror the waiver language to the extent possible in the findings, but also where there was some additional information that wasn't in the waiver, but that seemed to, because I did listen to the tapes from the last meeting, so sometimes the findings do have a little bit more detail than was specifically in the waiver. But I tried to mirror it to the extent possible, too.
And this language is only to reflect intention of the waiver, which is in line with what the applicant is proposing, so I think it's maybe a language issue, Tony, but I feel like...
But as Tony said, I mean, there's... you can say it's 300 feet, but is the center line, is it an 18-foot road? Is it a 14-foot road? You know, so the 300 feet is just a... I'm not going to say it's a random number, but it's...
Well, numbers, I mean, 55 miles an hour. I mean, you know, you have to pick a number.
You know, generally on highways, that's what you use, is 300 feet.
Mm-hmm. So essentially, we have a high point up here. This is the eastern part.
Right.
Leaning on the Sugarloaf.
Right.
So we have a high point. We have water coming this way, we have water coming this way. 300 feet. So 300 feet on this plan would be, say, 300 feet. There's not enough flow to really do anything here, so being around where we want to capture it is where we're flattened out at the intersection. So there's the first new one, there's the first new one coming around. And don't forget, this is all swale on the outside. So we're trying to meet your LID requirements in this one. So we have two catch basins here, and we have 4 catch basins at that intersection. So they're strategically located at the intersection. Not up here.
It's getting it coming off of that side road too.
Coming from just, and don't forget, all of this water from the back of the house is back down in here. So all you get is the driveways in the front going out. So and I can show you in the report. Just look at this. I want to get too technical, but I don't want to. My only concern is I don't want to put something in here now. And that's probably the only place that that takes.
And then out towards Sugarloaf, there's more?
Well, we have storm drain. That's not an issue. That's standard here. So this is the section of the test pitch.
So because...
Here's all the calculations on the spread and the water. Each catch basin is analyzed for how much capacity it has. And from the circuit design to the land. So that's how we calculate that, to make sure that we have dry road in the middle. So in a big storm, we can even pass.
Yeah.
So it's economics. And like I said, we look at slopes and we look at cross slopes. And there's appropriate places to put catch basins as opposed to just the road. And so you're heavy intents at the intersection, okay? And then what we have is a high point in here, so it goes back. We picked up drainage right here. This is where we bring it into the system. Mm-hmm. This is an oil water separator. We pick it up here. We have catch basins here that drain to here. We have catch basins that drain, so we've got a very limited amount. But we do have catch basins right at the intersection that tie directly to the municipal stormwater system.
Right.
So I'm not sure if I would take 300, because I don't analyze it that way and spread them out, whether we'd have the same amount of catch basins, but these are strategically based on hydraulic conditions and hydraulics in the street.
So in a nutshell, because of the implementation of the low-impact devices, the 300 feet is not a requirement because...
Well, that's part of it, yes.
Right, so I mean, I think this is language, maybe that's some language that we could add, you know, to...
Well, it's also, I mean, I guess this is also, it's going to come up in our waivers, so... So are we okay with taking out that last sentence on F?
Yes, but I think we should add a little bit of language because of the low impact devices.
Actually, that's in the next page.
Well, the waivers are already voted, so you won't be
right.
Changing.
So, so that's
okay. Well, then take
it. It refers to
I guess the point
LID
is it explains
elements.
The waiver,
right?
For the document, but
all right, I'm good with that.
So you're striking that?
We'll strike that last sentence.
Strike that. And then do you want to have a discussion about adding language, or are you okay with what is here now in the various findings?
Let's go to the waivers and see if...
Okay, not the waivers, the conditions.
Well, no, actually, the next section is about the...
Oh, the waivers. Okay.
Well, the waivers just report what you already voted at your last meeting, but we can go over that.
Yeah.
So now we've basically done with the findings. So you did vote at the last meeting to approve the three waivers, so this was...
Well, wait a minute. Now, are we going to review B, or is that all done?
Yeah, I'd like to come back to that after
okay,
we get
right.
the conditions. That's a hold right, for
good.
Coming
okay.
back after we look at the conditions.
Good, okay.
And we agreed to take out that last sentence on F and may do a little bit more wordsmithing there, too. We've taken out H. There were no other findings recommended. So now we can move on to what you approved last... Well, I was going to say last month, but it wasn't last month, was it?
2 weeks ago.
So the first section, 4222 intersection spacing waiver, in each of these cases, I went back to the videotape and I watched it to try to really get the sense of the board. I tweaked it a little bit because sometimes, you know, English language looks different on the paper than it does when it's coming out of our mouths. But I really tried to be very truthful in terms of representing what you guys said. So, intersection spacing. The board approved on April 3, 2017, by a vote of 5-2-0, the requested waiver of this section, which requires that the intersection shall be separated by not less than 600 feet on collector streets, such as Sugarloaf Street, to allow the proposed distance between the two entrances of 285 feet. Next waiver is in regard to the placement of the structures. Section 4340. The board approved on April 3, 2017, by a vote of 5-2-0, the requested waiver of this section, which requires that catch basins shall be required on both sides of the roadway at intervals of not more than 300 feet, except where drainage swales are used to allow catch basins to be located as shown on the plan to complement the proposed swales and other LID elements for managing stormwater based on hydrologic considerations and not the 300-foot rule. Now, actually, as I'm reading this, this right. is just the original language. This isn't the actual motions. I'm trying to, I did write up the actual motion. So this just tells, based on what the nature of the merger, of what the waiver requests were, what you voted to approve. I provided that information in an email. And now, of course, here it is. So this is what language I provided to Paul ultimately to put into the email. So the first one, intersection spacing. The motion was to grant the waiver. This was motion was made by Paul and seconded by Kip. To grant the waiver of section 4222 of the Deerfield subdivision regulations requiring 600-foot intersection spacing to allow the 285-foot spacing as shown on the plans, on the basis that the waiver is in the interest of the town and that it will help meet the demand for housing for residents 55 years of age and older, and the resulting reduction in traffic justifies locating the intersections closer together than would be otherwise acceptable. So that one was tricky because it got complicated with the addition of the 55 plus piece into it. But so that is reflected that was the main reason why you agreed to vote to allow the intersections to be closer. Secondly, on the structures, the motion was made by Kip, seconded by John Baronis, and was voted 5-2-0. The motion was to grant the waiver of Section 4340 of the Deerfield subdivision regulations and allow locating catch basins other than at the general rule of 300-foot intervals due to the fact that catch basins located at more hydrologically appropriate locations would be in the best interest of the town and the project itself and are consistent with standard engineering practices. Now you may, my computer didn't like the word hydrologically, and you may object to that term, but it is what you said, and it's very clear what you meant by that, so I left that. And then finally, the placement of monuments, which is Section 4562, that motion was made by Kip and seconded by John Baronis. That vote was, it was approved by a vote of 6-1-0. And the motion language was to grant the waiver of Section 4562 of the Deerfield subdivision regulations for monument placement and allow applicant to set iron rods or pins in lieu of concrete or granite bounds at the four major internal corners of each lot. So that is what will go in the minutes, unless you guys, you know, and you'll have an opportunity then to also address any specific changes in that language that you might like to make. So that, but those waivers were approved, so that we're just wordsmithing to make sure it got what you said, but that's all done. Then on the middle of page 3, we move to number 5, which is where we get to the real meat of the matter, which is conditions.
Let's approach this now.
The first is that there, sir.
Sorry. We do have a question.
Is that, okay. Yeah. Mr. Chair.
To your issue about, or discussion about, what, should that line be replaced on F, we think that the structure, Section 4340, describes exactly what's happened. The bylaw allows waiver of this section, allows catch basins shall be required on both sides of the roadway as intervals of not more than 300 feet, except where drainage swales are used to allow catch basins to be located, as shown on the plan to complement the proposed swales. That's right. Actually right out of the...
Right, but, as yeah. I agree.
So we're thinking maybe
that.
If you want to add to our...
If we need to add anything.
Right, you could add that to that.
Yeah, we're okay with
good
the waiver
suggestion.
Language.
Okay. Yeah. All right, so you guys ready to go into conditions? Mm-hmm. The first couple are just basic, but... lots upon which buildings may not be erected. So there are a couple. There's three lots with existing structures, A, B, and C, as identified on the plans. And then D and E are community lots, which are designated as unbuildable, again, on the plans. The number of buildings that may be erected are 35 duplex buildings containing a maximum of 70 residential units. And then where it says additional conditions is really where all of the real conditions are. God bless you.
So I just want to ask, is that still the plan, up to 35 duplex buildings?
We're going to follow the plan that's in front of the board, which is 35 duplex units. Mm-hmm. Yep. That's the intent.
If you, this would be a time when, if you wanted to reduce the number, we could discuss it.
I thought the addition of a maximum of was a good addition because, as you pointed out, some people might put units together and then they would count as a single unit, and you might not actually get to 70 even if you build out your 35
buildings. Correct. We have one of those
buildings.
Already. Yeah.
So I think that was good. All right. So under C, we get into what is now was sort of a long list to start and is now a really long list of conditions. So we'll go through each of these one by one, Mr. Chairman, as we
yes.
did. You want to do the same thing, put a hold
yeah,
on
again,
it as we go?
Yeah, because some of them overlap, okay. So let's go through them all.
All right. Number one, the applicant shall construct the condominiums at Sugarloaf according to the site plan entitled Definitive Subdivision Plan. The condominiums at Sugarloaf, prepared for the Futures Limited, 7 Oak Knoll Drive, South Deerfield, prepared by SVE Associates. I'll forego all of the contact information for Tony. Dated December 15, 2016, various sheets revived January 25, 17, February 2017, March 2, 2017, and March 22, 2017. And there had been a question earlier that the chairman had raised about whether when the date of the plan said March 22, if we needed to say as to individual sheets what their dates were. And I had actually, as things were going along, individual sheets were coming to me. And as that was happening, I had identified them. But then on March 22, SVE created a final plan set with all of them in there, each page noting on it the dates upon which it was revised and why. So that's why I just referred now to a March 22, 2017 plan set. I assume that makes sense to you,
yeah,
too?
Yeah, that's typically how we do it, yeah. Because as we go through the process, there's changes, whether it be Mass DOT or your peer review, and we just kind of, when we're at the end, just lump it together. But there is a revision box in there that talks about the sheets. Well, on the cover sheet, we usually label the sheets that were changed by that delta and the reasons why in each revision block. Yeah,
That's what I just wanted to hear, is that there is that we know which ones needed to be revised and they were.
Yeah.
That's all.
Because
we just say
right
various
on the
sheets.
Right on the cover sheet, each sheet gets changed. Yeah. Well, that's how we do it. Because otherwise I can't tell which sheets were changed if I don't do it that way. Right.
So that March 22, 2017 is the operative date for the plan set. And any holds on this condition? No? Not seeing any, I will proceed to number two. Applicant shall provide an adequate performance guarantee pursuant to section 3500 of the Deerfield subdivision regulations and agreeable to Deerfield Town Council prior to the endorsement of the definitive plan by the Deerfield Planning Board to ensure the construction of ways and stormwater management systems and the installation of municipal services for this subdivision. Failure to provide such performance guarantee may result in rescission of approval of the definitive plan. No building permit shall be issued by the building, and I'm going to say it's building inspector, town council refers to him that way all along. It's building commissioner, we'll go back and fix it, but I will read as it is here now. So no building permit shall be issued by the building inspector until the ways, stormwater management systems, and municipal services are constructed or installed as applicable or sufficient security has been provided for their completion. Holds further discussion? Looks like we got a hold on this one. Okay. Number three. In determining the amount of any bond or surety, if applicable, the board shall be guided by the following formula. A, the board's estimate of the cost to complete the work, plus B, a 10% margin of error, plus C, an appropriate rate of inflation over a five-year period. Hold for further discussion?
If we just hold it,
Four. I mean, there's a number of items here referring to the bond and surety, so it may be that we'll discuss all of those, going back. But so four is another. Any bond or surety shall contain the following provision. Quote, if the principal shall fully and satisfactorily observe and perform in accordance with the qualifications herein and as specified in the covenants, agreements, terms, and provisions set forth in A, the plan of record, and B, the decision, then this obligation shall be void. Otherwise, it shall remain in full force and effect, and the aforesaid sum shall be paid to the town of Deerfield upon demand as liquidated damages, end quote. Want that to be part of the hold for future discussion?
Yes.
Remember, Planning Board, these are, I should say, these are in the highlights of our town council.
Yes, so that highlighting, so this is a comment.
These are not our words, so.
So here's the comment, here's town council's comment. Should the applicant seek to substitute a bond, cash account, or letter of credit for the statutory covenant, these provisions provide a manner of calculation of the requisite sum. Number five. Applicant shall provide details of the planned phases of construction for review and approval by the planning board prior to the endorsement of the definitive plan by the Deerfield Planning Board.
I'm going
to
give them that.
Hold on 1 second, please.
Sure.
Okay. We do have a...
Yeah, hold on that one, too.
We'll hold... No, we'll let that go. But we do have a phase construction. I actually have it here, but it probably would be more appropriate to submit that when we get all of the other stuff to you prior to endorsement of the definitive plan.
That's great. If you're already ahead of the game on getting that
one. Yeah, that's completed. Yeah.
Okay. All right, we'll move... No holds from the planning board on that one? Okay. Number six. Applicant shall provide the opportunity for the town of Deerfield or its representative to inspect each key element of the road, water, sewer, and stormwater management systems, including subgrade, compacted road base, trenching, and backfill during and after construction, according to a schedule of inspections to be determined by agreement with the Deerfield Planning Board prior to the endorsement of the definitive plan.
Okay.
I have a question about that. When we say the town of Deerfield is represented, is that another peer review opportunity?
Could be.
I don't understand that.
So we're leaving it, on this one, it's left open that it could either be a town of Deerfield employee or an independent agent who would, could be contracted with as a peer review engineer.
I was more comfortable
that it was decided. And then later, there's another condition you will see that has been added that's assumes it's an independent agent.
Right.
So you guys need to, this is something that could, you don't need, necessarily need to decide tonight, maybe able to word it in such a way that that decision can be made in the interim period while we're reviewing these other matters prior to endorsement.
Okay.
You know, the highways, the highway superintendent, the superintendent of public works, sometimes does it, but oftentimes they don't have time. So that's,
yep,
that's something we can discuss later.
We'll come back.
That's mine. That's a hold.
So that's just sort of a hold because I think we're going to discuss that further.
Yep.
It is definitely a hold.
Seven. Within 60 days of completion of each phase of the construction of the project, applicant shall submit as-built drawings to the Deerfield Building Commissioner and a complete set of as-built drawings upon completion of all of the phases of construction.
Just my own clarity. So when we say construction, are you talking infrastructure construction?
Yes.
Or not individual homes?
No, this is for these plans.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Road, yeah.
Any other questions? No? Any holds? No? Okay. Eight. Subject to the extension by the board for good cause shown, the ways, stormwater management systems, and municipal services shall be completed within 18 months from the date hereof.
Hold.
We'll hold that if done.
Two holds.
As noted here, there may be need to modify as necessary, and he had highlighted that 18-month time frame. Nine. Applicant shall construct, operate, and maintain the stormwater management system as detailed in the stormwater management plan dated December 13, 2016 and revised Appendix E, long-term operations and maintenance plan dated March 22, and that's 2017, mm-hmm. not 30. We've been doing this a long time, but not that long, guys.
We're not done yet.
Well, so that'll be an administrative change that will be made there. Any questions or holds on that?
And we have both of those plans.
Mm-hmm. Okay. 10. Applicant shall complete a road utility easement agreement and declaration of covenants as to road maintenance on an agreement relative to stormwater maintenance, Greylock Lane and Snowberry Circle, South Deerfield, SIC, Massachusetts, in a form acceptable to the Town of Deerfield's Town Council prior to the endorsement of the definitive plan by the Deerfield Planning Board. You've received a draft of that. It just needs to be negotiated. Yeah. I would change the title. It would be my first advice as an editor. I'm going, whoa. And it, as it's been noted, it's just Deerfield, not South Deerfield. But no other issues or holds on that? Okay. 11. Applicant shall provide the opportunity for the Town of Deerfield or its representative to inspect each key element of the stormwater management system before, during, and after construction according to a schedule of inspections to be determined by agreement with the Deerfield Planning Board prior to the endorsement of the definitive plan. This, I think, is now superseded by the changes that Sarah Campbell had suggested up in number 6, because it had originally been just roadways in that one and stormwater management system in this one, and now number 6 covers all of them. The revised number 6.
So are you proposing to remove 11?
I think 11 could be removed.
So you're holding that one then based on what, Deb, 6, right?
Yes.
So hold on number 11.
No.
Just, I would eliminate it.
Eliminate.
Yeah, but do you want
to
eliminate
it? We're going to talk about 6, but it covers it now. We may tweak what it says, but it now covers the stormwater management system, which this one was set to do. So anything we can do to reduce duplication, I think, would be good here. 12. During construction, applicant shall conform to all local, state, and federal laws regarding noise, vibration, dust, and blocking of any roadways. Applicant shall at all times, use all reasonable means to minimize inconvenience to residents and businesses in the general area. Construction of ways and of the stormwater management system and installation of municipal services shall not commence on any day before 7 a.m. and shall not continue beyond 6 p.m. Monday through Saturday, with no construction or installation on any Sunday or state or federal holiday. Hours of construction and installation, as aforesaid, shall be enforced by the Deerfield Police Department. The note says the enforcement agent could be some other party. It's up to the board to determine. Any questions or further discussion needed on those?
We're okay.
Pretty standard.
Yeah.
You want to leave it open to...
You want to leave it open to determine...
Determine, you know, or other appropriate facility instead of... If you want to leave the condition open for you guys to discuss, you could just put or other appropriate town official.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, so leave it the way it is.
Please, the chief doesn't want it.
Yeah, I don't know if they talked to chief about this. So, or other appropriate town representative.
All right. Well, it could be the building official, like they say.
Could be.
Building inspector.
Would
or other appropriate town official is good.
Or other appropriate town official.
Officials.
Okay.
All right. Yeah, Kip.
He's getting bored.
Kip, you're hanging around town, huh?
Well, I was going to say, although that sounds really good, the town has been involved in the exact same situation, and it's almost impossible to enforce.
Very
I was just going to say,
police can't do anything either.
Right.
It's not a criminal offense.
If it's a condition, we can stop there.
You can say what you want, but
progress or
something we're doing.
Enforcement is always a challenge.
Yeah.
Okay. 13.
Yeah. It's a great comment on that, I guess. I want to make sure if you're going to change this, that we don't have, you know, several departments coming at us. We need
I would just leave the police department.
I just feel like I
just leave it at the police department.
I also think
leave it at the police department.
You don't want to fall in between.
They're best equipped.
That, right.
Okay. Is that consensus? Yes? All right. We'll leave it as is. Number 13. All construction shall be undertaken in accordance with the following conditions. A. The applicant shall abate potential nuisances associated with construction activities, such as dirt, dust, litter, noise, and glare, employing all reasonable means to do so. No comments or holds?
No.
B. No construction-related vehicles, e.g. expressly including the personal vehicles of contractors, subcontractors, and others working on site, shall be parked on Sugarloaf Street or other surrounding roadways.
We agree.
Everybody's good with that? C. Traffic detail shall be provided on Sugarloaf Street at applicant's expense whenever heavy construction vehicles are entering or exiting the site, as may be determined by the building inspector upon consultation with the applicant or its representatives.
It's worded a little oddly because there'll be heavy equipment going in every day, trucks, you know, dirt trucks and things of that fashion, I'm sure. So I'm putting a lot of faith in our building commissioner to make sure that he's not going to be too aggressive on how often. It seems like it's not worded great. Lee?
Yeah.
Well.
Yeah, and the comment does say the building inspector should act reasonably in requiring police details.
Right.
Because obviously the expense purpose of detail is public safety, but given the cost of that is so.
Right.
Is there a wordsmithing you guys would like to do on that one, or you want to just put
I would say yes, because the way that reads, if I were just reading it, I would say that there needs to be a police detail there every single
day. If the commissioner says so.
Well, yeah, I mean, it's unlikely, but he could hold you to that the way that this reads.
Right.
All right, well, we'll put a hold on that then, and we'll come back to that. D, all construction vehicles shall be cleaned before exiting the site so as to avoid the spread of dirt and debris off-site via vehicle tires or otherwise.
We're fine with that.
Okay. E, the use of engine braking systems by construction vehicles is prohibited.
Thank goodness. Yeah. We're fine with that as well.
Okay. Any comments or holds? No, I don't see any on this part. 14. A clerk of the works or equivalent independent site engineer shall be provided by the town at applicant's expense as deemed necessary by the building inspector. The clerk of the works is expected to supervise and review the construction of roadways and stormwater management systems, as well as the installation of municipal services for the proposed subdivision. The clerk of the works or site engineer's services shall be as needed for a reasonable number of hours and at a customary rate for his or her services in recognition of the cost associated therewith.
So we did just receive this an hour and a half before the meeting, so I apologize if we have to stop for a second and have a conversation.
So this, for the board members, this is relates back to where we were talking about in the town of Deerfield or its designated
right, third-party inspection service.
Yeah, so this goes straight into
building inspector
equivalent independent site engineer, the building commissioner
building inspector
determining.
Yeah.
As has been noted, there's already a typically, when there's an earlier condition, says you this inspection schedule will be set ahead of time. So that will all be set out. There may be additional times during the, you know, for whatever reason, the building commissioner might feel that an additional inspection were required, but it was anticipated that everybody would know in advance prior to endorsement what that inspection schedule would be, what the items would be, and when, you know, how that inspection would go forward.
I guess that's my, we can talk about it after a hold, but okay. It seems like that's redundant with the inspection schedule and that issues would come up.
Well, we need to meld them better.
Yeah.
So we'll put a hold on this and we'll go back to that.
So we were talking while you were having that discussion, yeah. But on the fly, I think you were saying the same thing we were saying over here at the same time, and that is that there will be an inspection schedule that we'll agree upon. The building commissioner will make the decision whether or not he feels he needs a clerk of the works to intercede on any of those, or if he feels as though, as I understand this, he's the one that's going to be looking over this road during construction.
The intention is it would not be the building inspector, but that it would be someone else.
Another agent.
Either a clerk of the works, or if you want to call it an independent site engineer, or just an inspection engineer, but it would be somebody other that he would make. He would determine when it were necessary, but I don't think he would be the one doing it.
Well, that's what I'm referring to, yeah. So he'll determine whether or not it's necessary to bring in a clerk of the works on those issues.
Yeah.
Okay.
And
we're
and,
saying the same thing.
And
there's
question whether it should be and or planning board.
Right.
Should
the planning board, I was assuming the planning board would be the ones that would be negotiating the initial inspection schedule.
Right, and then leave it to the
building commissioner. Certainly, could be included in that.
How could the planning board do that? I mean, we're all part. We have a hard enough time getting together for a meeting.
No, right. I'm saying when we get the phase thing, there might be certain phases that we say we want an independent engineer to look over it at when that phase is being done, or something like that.
Inspection service, not necessarily engineer.
Yeah,
wouldn't that be up to the building inspector, who's going to be dealing with it every day?
What I'm suggesting is that this is the biggest
not for the roadway
project. This is a big project in Deerfield, and I think we have limited capacity in our building department there. So I want to make sure that there's some other individuals are available if need be.
In the other subdivisions I've done in other towns, the way they've handled it is they actually brought up a representative of the DPW over. At times when they felt they had something, in other words, if you have a schedule, that's
right.
Helpful because of the note, we'll call them and say, hey, we're doing this today, and they can send somebody over to take a look.
Right.
That seemed to be the easiest. The gentleman that was working for the DPW in Greenfield when I did one was there randomly as well. He was able to come over at our, that was fine with us, where he can come over anytime he wants so that he didn't have to be announcing himself for just the list of. So maybe that's how we deal with this.
That's why the original condition that I had written, I put it could be a town official thinking maybe it could be the DPW superintendent, but there needs to be further discussion about whether the capacity exists, and no one has ever at this point had a discussion with him about that. Right. So I didn't want to tie it down in here. I wanted to kind of leave that open for further discussion.
Yeah, I mean,
to set up that there will be an inspection schedule and everything will be inspected, and it would be preferable if there was a single inspector who went along the whole process. That would make it simpler for everybody.
It would, unless there's certain aspects of it that are...
Maybe you need to bring in a higher level.
Or lower, well, yeah.
Yeah.
Maybe somebody else. It might be a specification of somebody else, another.
So we have a little bit of work to do on this one. You want to keep reading, or you want to keep talking?
Yeah, keep going, because then so the 6 and 14 need to go together. Right. Is what we're saying now.
Okay, 15. Applicant shall provide the town and the public with the name, telephone number, and email address for a contact person available Monday through Friday during normal business hours to whom inquiries can be made, information provided, and concerns raised about construction.
By who are making these calls to me?
People who can't get their cars out because there's a truck, you know,
I mean, yeah, it doesn't. You know. You're right. It does not specify that.
Right.
Right. This could become. Yeah.
I'm presuming that it would be town officials, not necessarily that this would be broadcast on the town website.
Well, that's what I was getting at. Is if somebody has a problem, they would think they would call the police department if it's something of that fashion, and they would contact me, so that I'm not fielding calls from people
public.
Who oppose the project. And there's 30 calls every hour.
Yep. Dan Graves hotline.
Yeah. It's too expensive.
Call away.
Council did make a note as to query whether the contact person may be a representative applicant or must be an independent party. The latter has a cost associated with it, of course, so I guess he's considering perhaps that might, I don't know, maybe that would be Tony or somebody or Dan. I don't know. I'm not sure exactly what.
Not Tony.
That
What I'm thinking is that...
Probably the superintendent that's working on the project, or the project manager.
Dan's in my ear here also about saying, let's just go move forward with this, but I think it's important we get it clarified as to who's going to, you know, where we're going to get these calls from. I just want to...
Well, it does say the town and the public.
Right, there's been some animosity here, and I would like to make sure that this is not going to become... I want to make sure I'm taking care of every call that's made, but it's a legitimate call. So if there is a an ability to funnel this through somewhere, someone at the town, and then it goes to my road construction supervisor, or it goes to me.
Well, I think that's why the council suggests that it could be an independent party. So they don't go straight to you. They, you know, they are vetted by somebody else. Now, whether it's somebody in the... Because
imagine that's going to go and to our already overtaxed town offices. Yeah. So well, that's what we don't want to do, is we don't want to set up a whole...
We want them to just have a number. Here's
who
you call.
We don't want them to have a whole other
I'm guessing my feeling is that the way it works in town now is if something's going on a public street that's not supposed to be happening,
they
like a driveway, they call the police. Mm-hmm. So I would think that would make sense that the police would be called, and I would be able, they would go out and see if there's a problem. If there is an actual problem, then whoever we have as our representative would have a phone on them during the regular business hours to make sure they're able to be contacted. So that we can take care of it immediately. I'm just trying to, make sure we focus it so it happens
quickly.
So
the question may be more that who do the police call, right? So they could call you and you'd be like, oh, well, I don't know whose truck it is.
So first would be, who does the public call? And then I would call that, say it's the police department, mm-hmm. and then the police department.
Or the town offices. Because people do call the town offices. Yes. You can't control the public. You don't say, I'm sorry, public.
Yeah.
You can't call anybody except for this one person. You know, they're going to call the place.
So,
I don't think the public interacting with an independent party or with a developer would bring the resolution to the town, even because there wouldn't really be any information on whether the issue was resolved.
Right. There's a conflict then.
No, absolutely. But the point is that it is still more, it's taxing an already very slim, you know, administration, very streamlined. We look the efficiency of this administration, but there's not a lot of fat for, this kind of. So I think that's what we're looking at, is some sort of process by which they're vetted and they're going to the right place, that the public can get some satisfaction. They're not feeling like they're being stopped. You don't want that any more than anybody else does.
So at the end of this, it'll still be going to the police department. So my thought would be, if they call someone in this office, that they refer them to the police department as they would on any other issue regarding a town street. So that if there's a problem, they say my driveway's being
blocked,
shut down by Deeds Construction, whoever I'm using for the contractor, that they would say, please call the police department, they'll take care of it immediately, and we'll get a call. We'll have somebody with a independent cell phone that is just for those calls, and it'll be either myself or the superintendent of the road construction. So I think that it needs to go from this to funneled into one spot for the town that then comes to us after they verify that there is an issue. Mm-hmm. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does. I'm still back at, I think that's a sensible plan. I'm still back at, where's the cost? Time is money. And so, you know, if and this is just, we have to prepare for if there's a problem. And you don't want a problem, we don't want a problem. So we're not anticipating it, but we have to prepare for it. If there does seem to be a series of things, we don't want that to become something that is superseding other town business that we're already
So that goes back to the other condition you had in here, that if we block roads to park cars on, we're shut down. So I think you have your answers to what happens. It won't be 20 calls over 10 days. It'll be a call. We take care of it. If there's a problem, I don't anticipate there will be, but if there's a problem, we take care of it immediately. And we move on.
Right.
If there is multiple problems, then before it becomes a hassle for the department, Deerfield Police Department, or this office, you folks step in as the planning board and say, we've had enough, we're closing you down until you figure out how to straighten this out.
Well, I may go back to the Department of the Works thing.
I think it's for more issues than just if something's going on, you know, on Sugarloaf Street. So to Rachel's point, with the cost, and not to add cost to your project, but I can't imagine that, like a Crocker Communication or something, an answering service like that.
But how are they going to qualify the question?
Well, I know, that's where, but if
ever call a medical office?
Well, that's what I mean. We don't want to do that to somebody.
I know. If we have a clerk of the works, I mean, we could go back to that, too. That's something.
That's not a daily. That's not someone who's there daily.
Because I have a funny feeling there probably will be a lot of calls.
To begin with.
Well, to begin with.
Even if there aren't any issues.
Listen, we just, you know, any project, there's a conflict. Any project. It's ill will, goodwill, whatever, you know. There's always going to be some bump. So we want to be in the position of managing that without overburdening and already.
So if they call the police department can vet what's being said and send it to the appropriate.
Correct. Who takes care of it immediately.
Right.
Yeah, but that way they'll go out, make sure if there is or is not an issue, and then we'll respond to it when we're called. This way we'll make sure that.
So it sounds to me, I'm
okay. Any thoughts over here?
No, I think we're talking the right way. I don't see.
Yeah, I mean, if somebody calls, they should be heard.
Yeah.
So,
and directed to the police so they can get satisfaction. Police take a look and make sure there is or is not an issue. And then my representative is contacted, and we're required to make sure we take care of whatever it is. And if we don't, then
you're talking about a specific issue. I'm also, if there's a curiosity about something, then I think they can call the building inspector also, who should be on top of things.
Well, and the police should be able to vet that question.
Again, back to Rachel's saying we're not trying to overburden the police.
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
Or the town office.
I think.
Or the commissioner's.
What about signage? Know? What if I put something up in front stating, you know, questions regarding the project, call, you know, this number.
That is a bad idea.
And then another one that says on the bottom of it, if you have an issue, call the police.
Right.
You know, call the police.
Right.
You know, something in that fashion. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think that's kind of more what we're after here.
Okay.
But it's still.
I mean, and then this says about Monday through Friday during business. I mean, if it's an emergency, we want to have a contact person.
Always.
The town should always have a contact person.
Right. Someone with a phone on them is dedicated specifically to answering for just this.
Correct.
Yeah, we're in agreement.
Not bigger than 32 square feet, you'll be in violation of
signs. No,
right. Be very careful. We've got issues in this town about signs.
I asked if there's, you know, because there's 70 lots, if I'm allowed to have.
One per each.
Just two. Right.
Barber signs.
Yeah. So we'll have to work that out with the building inspector.
I think we're getting closer to, or would you be willing, Mr. Chairman, for them to come back with some revised language on that?
Do you want to come back, or should we come back?
You can come back with what you would like, and then have the board.
I think we're getting to the same page. There's the emergency number at contact, and then there's the more general information number, but if it could be at the sign at the front of the lot, that'd be great.
I think that works. And, you know, so if you have it wouldn't be an emergency issue, but if you have an issue with the project, if you have if you want information regarding the project, call this number.
Right.
If you have an issue that needs to be
taken care of immediately,
call this number.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That'd be great.
That'd be fine. Then we'll have that funneled to one phone. I didn't word it well.
Well, that's why we need to do a little smithing. So if you guys can, I've got a little bit, if you could, when we come back.
Okay.
Because we ended up talking about
burden
that one for
of
a
cost.
Longer time.
I mean, I don't anticipate a big burden of cost, but if there, I don't know what you decide at that point, if there's a burden of cost.
I think, again, if you find us violating constantly, the planning board's going to call us in and say, look, this is not what we agreed on. You aren't doing what you're supposed to do. We've incurred a cost that
schedule.
We expect you to incur. Mm-hmm. And if it continues, we're going to charge you X amount of dollars.
Mm-hmm. And that's the thing I'd like to see. I'd like to see that kind of put in there.
Does that make sense, Rich?
Yes.
Okay.
Thanks.
Okay, we ready to move on to 16? We'll come back to that with some new wording in a little while.
Yep.
Applicant shall restrict sales within the condominium subdivision in perpetuity to purchasers with at least one resident age 55 years or older, consistent with applicant's presentations.
Correct.
No more comment? Okay. 17. Applicant shall be responsible for the installation, operation, and maintenance of all aspects of the stormwater management system until all of the units in the condominium have been conveyed. Thereafter, the operation and maintenance of the stormwater management system shall be the responsibility of a condominium association and or a management company contracted by the association.
So I have a comment on that. Typically, in ones that I've been involved in the past, when you reach a certain percentage of the units sold, it is then typically handed over to the condo association. So it's not at the time when all units are constructed. And it could be that there's many factors that might stop us from wanting to construct all of them at once. My intention is to go straight through. The way the phone's ringing, I don't think I'll have a choice. But the idea is that I think we'll be able to handle this or hand this over to a condo association prior to all the units being constructed.
Right, so it sounds like we've got to hold on the all.
Yeah.
The other things you want to comment on?
I know I started to answer it right now.
No, you can. You're the chairman.
So, because I said the same thing, the planning board. I think our major concern is we always want to know. We want always want someone managing the stormwater system.
Right.
We don't really care if it's the applicant or the condo association. Right.
As long as it's not us.
Yeah. So the main point here is to applicant.
Sorry. We're trying to make it all.
We had all the answers to the first one you guys asked. Yeah.
So we want to get rid of the all. We really don't care
whether it's you
when.
Or
we just want to know that someone's managing the stormwater system. And so I'm not sure.
I think you just hit it.
You just word that. As long as it goes from the applicant to another entity that's going to be responsible, that's what we care about.
We don't want any.
And it may just be until another entity assumes legal responsibility for the same.
Yeah.
Like that.
Right.
Yeah.
So,
such as a condo or a management.
Yeah, because if you
right, somebody buys the whole
after three
thing
things
out,
are
they
sold,
still,
no whatever. Lapse in ownership of maintenance.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
So you would, instead of all of the units in the condominium would be conveyed, you would say until another entity assumes legal responsibility for same.
Such another as qualified condo entity assumes responsibility for the same.
Yeah.
Can we say such as a condo association?
Well, then leave the next sentence, right?
What's the next?
Thereafter, the operation and maintenance of the stormwater management system shall be the responsibility of condominium association and or management company contracted by the association. That gets you into what the qualified entity would be.
Qualified legal entity.
Yeah.
Yeah, it works for us.
All right. Okay, we smithed it. 18. The aforesaid condominium association or management company shall be responsible for ongoing maintenance of and repairs to the stormwater management system and any fixtures or components thereof.
And should there be something added saying if and until the road is taken over by the town?
Possibility. Sounds like we have a question.
Well, I don't want to sell my client down the road, but it probably should say the developer, because if something happened before the association was up and running,
the applicant.
Right. So the developer.
The applicant is what you've been
this
using.
Is 18?
So instead of aforesaid condominium association or management company, you want that to say developer?
No, I think it has to say both. I think if there's a period of time where the developer may be responsible for those things, and then down the road the association would be. But
let's keep the wording the same, though. You've got applicant, and I think everywhere else instead.
So it should be the aforementioned applicant and or condo association.
Yeah. Or what did you say,
applicant
John?
Or
legal, qualified legal entity.
Yeah.
Right.
Or okay.
So it's the applicant and or another qualified legal entity.
Well, we've talked about the condominium association and management company, and we left that last sentence in on 17, right? So we could still refer to them.
Yeah, I think what Rachel said makes sense, and what John Barona said makes sense, that if we put another qualified legal entity, such as condominium association and or a management company, and then we just track that same wordage to 18, verbiage to 18, saying the aforesaid applicant and any qualified legal entity such as a condominium association and or management company. Does that make sense?
Okay, so we'll do that both times.
It's almost one thing, but it's...
But it's a little different.
Yeah, it's a little bit different, so it's fine.
Okay, and then there was a question of whether that should then reflect the issue of whether or not the roadway would be taken over by the town. Is that going a step too far on that one, or...?
What I was suggesting is that, of course, once the town takes over, if the town takes over the road as a town road, then my obligations for maintenance of the stormwater management system in the 50-foot street width has ceased. Well, we need to get that particular. I mean, if it goes to town, it's obvious that you're taking it over, and I'm not going to be responsible for maintaining the road any longer. What do you think?
Yeah, we'll all be in that agreement.
I mean, that's one thing. We have not referred to this at all. If you notice that, I totally don't understand why the town would want to take it over. I know that's come up several times, but this is no way any indication Of the town's taken over any roadways.
We're not suggesting that. We're saying
so I'd rather leave. I don't want to have, I don't know
well, why. Well, I'm not going to be responsible for maintenance of the 50-foot roadway if the town takes over the road. And the reason they would take it over is because the people who are living there are paying the same taxes as everybody else in the town.
Let's see. Let's keep a hold on here and see if that issue is addressed at some of these other mm-hmm. conditions. Mm-hmm. And then so we can come back and see if we need to fix that more. 19. To provide the board and the town with assurances that neither the volume nor the rate of flow of surface and subsurface water from the Sugarloaf Range and surrounding aquifers to neighbors' properties will measurably increase as a consequence of development of the subdivision, applicant shall enlist the services of a professional hydrologist to test and record existing and post-development conditions on site and at the properties of parties of interest, meaning those entitled to notice of these proceedings under GL Chapter 41, Section 81T, but only insofar as applicant is permitted access to the properties of said parties in interest and indemnified and held harmless by them for any damage caused by or in connection with said testing and recording. Comment from counsel. Board is advised to consult with the applicant concerning the substance condition number 19, requires a significant undertaking by the applicant. The logistics and cost of the testing and recording of existing conditions ought to be discussed.
So I'll start this for us, and then I'll hand it over to Tony so he can get more on the specifics. But if we refer back to your own document here, 3D and 3B, we'll start with 3B. The soil evaluation data and summary from Dan Nietzsche includes adequate soil description that establishes the depth of seasonal high groundwater. D's, the proposed stormwater management system meets the requirements of the stormwater regulation of the town of Deerfield. We have expended tremendous amounts of time and money on this issue, showing where the seasonal high groundwater is. We've spent a tremendous amount of time putting the swale system that's required by the town and the state. I don't see anywhere in the bylaws that's suggesting that we would go to the expense of contacting every single neighbor that abuts this property to see if I could dig holes in their yard, to see if I'm putting water on their property. We follow the regulations for stormwater management. I can't see that this is fair or reasonable. Tony, do you have anything to add or Dan?
Nothing more to add. We met the requirements of the town stormwater management plan, also met the stormwater management standards of the state. I have nothing more to add, except I've not seen this condition ever placed on a project.
And I would just add, I don't even deem it a condition. I think it's a requirement that would have been addressed early on in the process, that it far exceeds what the subdivision control law is meant to incorporate, and to have it as a condition essentially places an unreasonable condition upon the developer that's not based on any of the subdivision control under Massachusetts law or the adopted law in the town of Deerfield or in the stormwater management. We have for 8 months, 12 months, sat down and gone line by line through the laws of Deerfield and complied with everything we could, with the exception of three waivers that we placed before this board, which the board voted favorably on. This condition is excessive, is far beyond subdivision control law, and we would object to it throughout.
All right.
Can I ask, can put that in there?
Council.
This is based on 4 months of public hearings with concerns by many. Let's just start with that. So we do appreciate that you've done all the stormwater management, you did the testing, and everything looks good. I think the question is the monitoring of it. How do we maintain? The other sort of issue I had was the same with the traffic. It's like right now it looks like, you know, we think everything's going to be fine, but, you know, what if there was, you know, the town needed to do something out on Sugarloaf because of this subdivision? The town shouldn't have to pay for it. Right now, no one, you know, we don't see that as that wasn't something that's we think is harmful to the town. So we'd like to figure out a way that this can be monitored. I mean, we all heard the concerns. The plan is a plan, and then reality happens afterwards. And we hope that the plan show us the reality.
John, this speaks to subsurface water. It doesn't talk about surface water.
Well, surface and subsurface.
Yeah, I mean, it talks about...
The subsurface water is a big concern in Deerfield. There's nothing, I mean, that's a really tough one, okay? Yeah. It's a wet town. It's a drought year. We can, you know, in fairness, this is a huge drought year.
It has nothing to do with what we've done for 10 years.
And I get that. And there's nothing you can do about that.
No,
one way or the other.
You understand the process. We haven't looked at water levels. We're just estimated seasonal high water tables.
Absolutely.
It has nothing to do with drought.
Yeah. No, and the point being, too, that it's a wet town, whether it's drought or not.
Well, our property is not a wet property. It's not a wet area.
Right, but people are concerned about water. And people have some pumps.
They can be concerned about water, but not on this property. We've done the due diligence. We've shown through four different licensed soils evaluators. We're only supposed to have one required by the state. We've had four out there, plus Mr. Kalaszewski, who is the soils analysis, soils evaluator for the town of Deerfield. We've shown where the water table is. It is low. We have a neighbor who lives next door who came to the first meetings. John has asked her to speak at every meeting now, and she's made the same comment. That the water is low on this property. We are understand and completely understand the concerns of the people inside this town that there are high water tables in the area, but we're not in that area. We are very fortunate in that fashion. We're not doing this. It doesn't make any sense. I'm certainly not going to be digging test holes on people's land who are to try and prove I'm not even sure what. I mean, it's a drought year, as you said, so one year it shows that we're having X amount of water go on their property or is going on the property. We can't base it on anything. Mm-hmm. And then we have another year, because we're showing in a drought year, we're going to dig the holes. Mm-hmm. And then 3 years later, while we're constructing the next portion of the road, they've got water in their cellar like they did for 5 years before the drought.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't make any sense.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Well, I just will reiterate what I said. This whole section 19 talks about groundwater that is below this project. And I understand it's a drought year, and if you folks don't understand it, the science behind looking for the seasonal high water is not where you see the water.
Mm-hmm.
It's an indication of, for sake of making it easy, a rust layer. And that, you know, like he said, there's been four or five experts looking at this. What this goes to is the groundwater that's going to be well below this.
Mm-hmm.
And there's no way that, you know, they can go onto everybody's property all around there. The other thing I can add is within a half mile, well, with the exception of that one subdivision, I think it's called Crestview, there is no other property in that area that has any surface water management program at all. So I don't see the need to... investigate this anymore. I mean, it's well below the water.
So my only concern with it, John, is that we could be digging 30 feet down to try and find water. You know, we were out there two weeks ago, and digging holes in the rain on a Monday after 3 days of rain during the snowfall, you know, where the snow melt had come through, and I was told we're going to have flooding of Sugarloaf Street and the rest, and we're going down 13 feet without hitting a drop of water. You know, it's just how far will we have to go?
So actually, if we could, sense. I'm going to come back to my hold earlier, the C there, just to see where the test pits are. Could you just show us? And
sure.
Are they on that, especially on the west side, I guess, on most?
The northwest side or the?
Are they not on one of these?
Yes, they are.
Oh.
Is there any capacity where I can add to this? I know the public line is close.
This is the original one,
by Michael
Dean. Oh, okay.
So I kind of just want to be assured that they were on that.
For instance, here, test pit 1, test pit 3, test pit 19, test pit 5. Test pit 13.
Is the board allowed to ask me questions?
As a hydrologist?
Ooh, that might be That might be a better way to get around.
So, Mr. Chairman, I did pull out the Dan Nietzsche report from GZA, and there is an additional map, and this shows his test pits 18 through 21.
Here's 20, here's test pit 15.
Let's see where those are.
Sorry, I don't know where they are, but that's, I mean, they're marked on the plan.
So. All right, so I'm looking mostly up on the left.
This is up next to Sugarloaf.
Right, so close to the backyards of the houses on Mountain Road. Can you, where would those be?
We didn't do any over here, but we have them in the road. Yeah. So we were in test pit 12, test pit 15, test pit 20. Down in the area in here, you have test pit 1. This is by Jeff's house.
Yeah.
Right here. So test pit 1, test pit 2, test pit 3. There's another test pit or 2 up here. These are the ones that I showed you at the intersection.
All right. So, that's
helpful. There's like 4 in here, another 3 over here. MassDEP requires us to do a number of test pits based on the square footage of the basin, so that's why you see more in those areas than throughout. But our due diligence, we test pitted throughout the whole property.
21 holes are recorded. We've dug over 40 now.
There's another serious problem to consider with this, is that even if the applicant agreed to it and say there's a concerned neighbor, these lots are extremely small, and you get a big machine in there, and you dig down 20 feet, and you hit the groundwater. Now, the landowners gave him a release saying that he's not responsible for what goes on because they want to know. And all of a sudden, 20 feet down, they hit water, and the banks start caving in, and it swallows the house. Well, the applicant's not responsible because the homeowner gave him a release. The homeowner's out of house. Who are they going to go after?
So I guess a question would be, the first sentence is that to provide the board and the town assurance that neither the volume nor the rate of flow of surface subsurface water from the Sugarloaf Range and surrounding aquifers and neighbors water will measurably increase as a subsequent of development of the subdivision. Like, so that's what we want to,
that's
the assurance we want. How can we get it?
We got it. We did the stormwater management to the state and the town's requirements. We've done what is required to make sure you're getting the result that you've required. If in the future you think you want to have monitoring and projects, I suppose you could add that to the regulations as out there as I think it is, but you know, we're following the regulations that are on this is almost like putting a new regulation into the book.
It's been peer reviewed by your consultant. It's been peer reviewed by MassDOT because they want to make sure that we're not increasing the flow, and we actually decreased the flow into Sugarloaf Street, and we improved this municipal system there. It's been approved by local district office. Is now off at the Boston because anytime you're doing stormwater connections, it has to go to Boston for review. So it's already been kicked out of the district office and been peer reviewed there. We've met your requirements.
What do you think?
John, I think the way water moves subsurfacely in town is probably my biggest concern. The science is there. Much of what's going to happen is going to be theoretical. Mm-hmm. And I don't say this as a joke. We're going to find out if our stormwater bylaw
works or doesn't work. Exactly.
Mark is right. Maybe we should revisit for this kind of testing post-construction in the future. However, at this point in time, it's adding a regulation that doesn't exist.
Right. I agree with John.
I'm keeping my fingers crossed for everybody. And, let's see if our stormwater bylaw works, because
you do have easements.
This is the first project that we've done in town
with it,
mm-hmm. The stormwater bylaw, I believe. Of a major size. So, I mean, I take this very seriously, the way the water moves, and but they have done their diligence up front. And I do know that is probably one of the driest pieces in town because it's the first one that Glinski used to get on for sweet corn. So
would there, procedurally, if I asked someone else that was here for comment, not new information, but to just clarify, I think we could get away with that. Is the board okay
I'm
with
okay
that?
With that.
I'm okay with that.
Deb, could you just help us work through? It's not new information.
But
in my capacity as a certified professional soil scientist.
Deb, you might want to step up to the mic.
Excellent.
I just want to state that I'm against this happening. This is a public comment by someone who is a neighbor to the planning project who has been very, very reasonable with us throughout it. But I believe we're stating the objection to this.
All right. As long as no new information, I'm okay.
Public meeting is closed.
Not as an abutter, but as a professional certified soil scientist, to address the questions that I've heard raised by the board, their plan is consistent in the sense that the same water that's coming falling on the site is going to be infiltrated on the site. It's being shifted into these infiltration basins. The only thing that would significantly raise the water table, as I have mentioned at previous meetings, would be if there were basements constructed into the water table, which were then using pumps to pump water out. Right. But simply the stormwater management as it's designed should not be raising the water table.
I want to make a comment that I wasn't concerned with Deb's comments. I felt confident where she would be coming with the comments. My concern is opening this back to the public on issues that have been discussed prior. You're on a slippery slope here.
I'm being very careful.
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. All right. So I think we don't need to hold this. I think we're pretty
wide.
Do we want to change it or strike it?
Strike it.
I think it needs to be struck because it's after the fact.
And too cumbersome.
All right, number 20?
Good. 19 is gone, right?
19 is gone. 20. Applicant shall provide evidence of satisfactory performance pursuant to sections 3700 and 3800 of the Deerfield Subdivision Regulations prior to any release of the performance bond or covenant serving as a performance guarantee for the subdivision project. Comments or holds?
No issue with that from our side.
Okay. Thank you, the board. No. 21. Excuse me. Approval of the plan by the board and any subsequent release of all or part of its performance guarantee shall not constitute the laying out or acceptance by the town of the subdivision ways.
We're in agreement.
The note is there that it's only town meeting and action by the board of selectmen can take care of that. Any holds from the board? No. 22. To the extent that the subdivision development or of subsequent use of the property requires any other permit, license, or approval from any official board, commission, or committee of the town of Deerfield, or from any agency of the Commonwealth or the federal government, whether as the result of any condition hereby imposed or otherwise, applicant shall make an appropriate application for and obtain the same.
No problems on this end.
Let's
have more like that.
It's hard to read that legalese. Sometimes a little tricky. But so we've gone through, dealt with a couple of issues, and there's still a couple of holds outstanding here. So let's go back to page 3. Our first hold is on number 2, which is in regard to performance guarantees. I believe that it was applicants' counsel, perhaps, that put that hold on. Am I misremembering?
No, I don't think it was 1 and 2. Can we start on 3 for holds?
Yeah.
Oh, no. I mean,
I have 1 on 2.
What about 2?
On the bottom.
I think everything was fine. The added red language, no building permit shall be issued by the building inspector until the way stormwater management system and municipal services are constructed or installed as applicable or sufficient security has been provided for completion. The way that I've seen this happen is you typically don't have to have the entire road built before you get a building permit to build a structure. Typically you have to have water service, sewer service, been inspected by the town and all working and have a binder course on the road before you can get an occupancy permit. This is going to be done in phases. The road will be constructed. I'm sure Mark's going to ask to get some foundation approval so they can start digging holes, even though before the binder is probably put down. So we'd want to have the ability to do that. That allows us to get some cash flow as we're moving through the project. But typically, the town building inspector won't allow stick construction to go up until the water system's in, so they have fire protection on the site. We just want to be able to move through the process in a typical way and not wait to have all of that binder down before we can dig a hole to build a foundation. Obviously, that has to be done, that portion, before you can get an occupancy permit to move people in. There's a lot of other things that have to happen, but just the nuts and bolts, that's the way we see this progressing through the project, and I just want to bring that up.
Let's make that easy for them, though, and suggest some wording for this, then.
No occupants, generally, if you don't want to do it, you say no occupancy shall be issued by the building inspector until waste, storm drainage system, municipal services are constructed or applicable or sufficient security has been provided for their completion. So
instead of building permit, occupancy.
I just say occupancy versus building is right. Where I would go with that. That's a suggested language change.
And for, just a CO there.
And for each phase. In other words, it's not going to be an entire road is done, which is suggestive in this.
So,
well, that's what I was going to say, because the phasing plan is going to help.
Correct.
With right. This too. So,
yeah. So no occupancy permit shall be issued by the building commissioner until the waste stormwater management system and municipal services are constructed or installed to service the lots in question. Is that where you want to go, or
individual units? Yeah.
The individual units in question
of that phase. Yeah. Of the phase under construction. Does that sound?
Individual units in question in that phase of construction.
And that sounds fine.
Yeah, that sounds good.
Now, my understanding, you got to put the water, you got to do the whole thing at once.
Yeah, except right. For Greylock, the middle street will probably be on its own phase. But we've got to loop it. We've got to get two.
Right.
Two. So that'll go in the first phase.
Yeah. Okay.
But we're just saying, to have it all finished off before we dig foundation holes, we're not going to do that. We probably won't pave the entire roads until we're done, so you get a nice finished product on the end. Right. Yeah.
So we're doing a couple of things that I want to comment to you guys as I think is important. The first phase is a lot of it. We're going to put most of all the storm water in. We have the concrete swale going in, and anywhere that's being affected, in other words, impermeable surfaces are being created, we're creating that stormwater area for that to make sure we're doing it correctly.
Mm-hmm.
We're also looking, and I can't guarantee it yet, we're checking the price, but you require 1.5 inches, and I'm not going to go on record saying we're doing this yet, but you require 1.5 inches for the binder course, and we're looking at doing a thicker binder course. We just want to stand up longer without any problems, and I'm not an advocate of this, but when we go to ask the town to take the road over, we want to show them it was done to a standard that exceeds what the requirements are.
That's what we want too.
All right, so that's good. So we'll just change that to occupancy.
So you guys, so we'll change it to occupancy, mm-hmm. And then we're eliminating the part about the sufficient security, because that's really covered elsewhere.
Right.
And we're referring to the constructed or installed as applicable to service the individual units in question in that phase of construction is how that will end.
Yep.
So we're set on that. Now, number three has a hold.
I think that's fine. I just wanted to read the subdivision law, and it's fine.
Yeah, that has the 10%. I think
it doesn't mention the inflation.
The five-year period inflation is different.
It is, but that's fine.
But you guys are good with that, and the board is okay with that?
No objection.
That's where we are.
On three? We're looking at three on the bottom of page three?
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Anything else? Okay, so then we're going to take the hold off, and we're good. Four. Now, this is when we get into the series of these relating to bonds. So the first one is has the provision about everything has to be satisfactorily observed and performed in accordance with the qualifications and a specified da 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 da. I'm not sure. I don't recall who put a hold on that one.
I think the bond questions all got put up together.
Yeah.
We don't have any objection to it.
And this is in 3500 performance guarantee.
Right? Yes.
So.
Yeah, we're fine with that.
Yeah, and he's just adding some additional language that needs to be included there.
Mm.
So if the applicant's good with it, does the board have any other additional questions?
Good.
So we'll drop the hold and we'll leave that one as is. Next one I had a hold on was six, which this is where we
this
get
is
to the...
Yeah.
Now, how different is 6
Town
and
of Deerfield is represented, so we want to look at 6 and 11.
I think
6 and 14 at the same time, and it's largely as to who will do it and how we want to, what kind of language we want to use here.
I think they're different. 6 and 14 are different. Oh, okay. I think 6 is about the project and the extra service required from the commissioner and potentially, you know, yeah. That's a lot. And as Kip points out, this needs to be done, you know, we're not going to run out there with our dogs looking at the connections and stuff like that.
Well, you need somebody who has the engineering expertise.
That's what I'm saying.
And I
don't think that the applicant, that's just sitting up straight, that makes everybody's working together, making it work down the road right. So I'm concerned about this one.
You're talking 6.
6.
Yeah.
Which is different from 14.
We have no problem with 6.
Okay. You don't have a problem with 6.
No, but these two have no problem. Wait a minute.
No, I don't know.
Well, I really think for a project of this size that we need to have an outside inspection service. You know, say when they're putting in the water line, doesn't necessarily have to be somebody there all the time, but, you know, doing a surprise visit once in a while.
We agree.
You know, keeps things honest.
So if you have a scheduled inspections, and then they have the right to show up.
Right. You know,
we're not going to say 4 times or whatever, but if they want to show up.
When you're laying the gravel down.
Correct.
You know, okay, there's a foot there.
Somebody, this should not preclude you guys from also having somebody from the water department or the
somebody
DPW
who is internal, too.
Who wants to come over and take a look.
So
not paying for them.
I need that, so you'll accept it.
Well, Roger's not here, but on his behalf, I'm sure he'll be there.
let's use the DPW for the other issues. But yeah.
So I think once a phase schedule is figured out, and then maybe we could get a construction schedule, and maybe we could work out, you know.
Correct. I agree.
That's what this envisions.
You know.
And Tony makes a good point that we want everything above board. Mm-hmm. You know, we try to be transparent through this whole thing. While we're constructing this road, we want to make sure it's above board as well. It's an additional expense on my side, but you're not asking for a clerk of the works to be there all day, every day.
No,
so
no.
What we're doing is going through a list of things that they'll check, some other impromptu appearances, whatever we call it. Where they can show up if they want to. And that you also have town officials who have the right to come over and take a look while it's going on so that the people in charge of those divisions aren't just taking the word of a clerk of the works.
You know, we don't have the, I'm not, lack of a better word, luxury of a town like Greenfield or Amherst where they have engineers and town inspectors. And
we're in agreement. Yeah, we have no problem doing that. We being me. To be more specific.
Well, again.
So that, is, but I'm just concerned about how
it's paid for.
Well, and how many inspections?
Yeah,
how many hours?
Then that's I think when we build that into some sort of schedule. I mean, that would actually put some bumpers on.
Well, we can supply you with the construction phasing plan. With that, we can supply you with what our experience has been when town would want to go and look. John's mentioned most of those are important times.
Yeah.
Drains before they're covered up, sewer laying, manholes, catch basins, the water line, to the right of way, you know, the services, they get to the right of way. And then subgrade, gravel, paving, curbing, you know, those basic. We'll do it, won't be able to tie it to exact dates, but we'll have those important task identified so you can review that.
And would we give them the person, I'm going to call them the inspector, we'll give them a notice saying, we anticipate doing this on next Tuesday, you know, so try and have your schedule set for that sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the other thing is once we give you that schedule, take a look at it, but you have two guys on the board, two people on the board. I don't know your background, but I know we have two people on the board.
I teach French.
So.
Whatever.
I need to talk to you, actually.
Yes.
So we have two people on the board that have construction, strong construction background. Again, I don't know your background, Paul.
No, I don't.
But, I mean, ultimately,
so
too, we're
a
volunteer board.
A lot of your paving companies today have QC, QA.
That's exactly what's going on with mine.
You know,
I've hired one of the largest paving companies construction companies in the valley that does subdivisions. I wanted somebody that really knew what they're doing.
All right.
Yeah. Good?
Excellent. Thank you.
So, honestly, you guys...
Can I just make a comment? This is not a public hearing, so we're not taking any comments. He had his hand up.
So I'm listening to what you're saying about 6 and thinking about 14. because I think they're getting they're both coming into the same place, mm-hmm. but from different angles. Mm-hmm. So what if we incorporated a couple of the elements of 14 into 6 that were key? So it sounded like you want to have the opportunity for town officials.
How are they different, though? I'm not seeing the difference.
I know, I'm not seeing the difference.
Okay, here's how I see the difference.
Thank you. Thanks.
Well, like, we need one. We need to combine them into one. Right? Okay, so let's hear what Rachel has to say.
She's just talking. So,
just don't do it in
French. The thing is, what my feeling is that the number 14 hits this kind of ongoing thing, which actually touches back to the 15, frankly. So maybe that's part of my problem is that 14 and 15 have to do with this kind of a liaison, if you will, not a clerk of the works, but some kind of connectivity with the town, whereas this other one is more technical. So I would say 6, sorry to parse it this way, but 6 is more about the guy that looks in the manhole before it gets soldered down, whatever.
Right.
And that we work very much, we've got it. But that 14 and...
15
have to do with this liaison. And again, not to impugn, no intention here,
that
just to say that that and again, my deep concern is for cost. I just don't want that to cost the town a whole lot more.
Mm-hmm. My deep concern is cost as well.
And we share that from the other side. I get that.
But what is the difference, Rachel? What this person does, it sounds like they're doing the same thing. They're going to inspect at various stages of the project to make sure it's being done correctly.
No, I feel you. Right. What I'm saying is that...
I think it's the wording that's throwing you, that it's just worded a bit differently.
It's the clerk of the works thing.
Yeah, so I think what we want to do is... I would suggest, humbly suggest, that number 6 and 14 are put together with the wording from 6. Yeah. It sounds like 6
and
is 14.
And then we hit 15.
And 15 is...
That's a separate... I think I see 15 separate, as a separate issue.
I know, but my problem is... Here's the thing. 6 talks nothing about cost. Again, I'm just going back to cost.
But we can add it in if we want.
Well, that's what I want. So right. Maybe that's where I'm really... I see 14 and 15, and I'm saying 6
we're
says, oh,
page.
Yeah, we're going to all move, and it's going to be groovy, and we're all going to do that. But somewhere, again, times
page.
Money
I'm
and...
For
right,
it.
From right. What I see from 14...
So both of those
maybe this will...
So that's it is a kind of merging all the.
Well, this might help you a little bit. I mean, we do have a building inspector and stuff like that. We do have plans. About the money part of it, he's already going to be paying the town close to $100,000 in fees. So that's part of what they do anyways.
Right.
You know?
No, actually, I'm not even so worried about him. I'm more worried about them, to be honest with you. That is my coordinating and. And I know, that's what the fees are for.
That's why we charge fees.
Right, 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 right. Yeah.
Well, 14 was language added by town council, and I do agree is it 6 and 14 are different. 14, I think the intent was to have a clerk of the works on site all the time, and that's not necessary. So
it wasn't. It was
to
just
be there at appropriate times. Certainly.
At appropriate times, as deemed by the building commissioner.
Yeah. So Rachel, if we took 6 and put at the applicant's expense,
that would make me happier.
Right. Shall provide the opportunity for the town of Deerfield or its representative to inspect, and then that brings into it says the town of Deerfield or its representative. So when we give you that list, and if it's building commissioner or somebody else, and says building commissioner says I can look at 1, 2, 7, and 14, but we want somebody in here for the other ones.
Right.
Right.
And leave it to him to decide which ones are and which ones aren't required.
Yep.
Does that make sense?
Yep.
Okay.
And we did add 14 includes the reasonable number of hours at a customary rate for his or her services, because we're all trying to maintain.
So,
really,
Pat, you're just going to meld 6
we're
and 14.
Not
what if, so what if we take, so following on what you just suggested, what if we take 6 and say, and make it read as follows? Applicant shall provide the opportunity for town of Deerfield officials and or independent site engineers provided to the town at applicant's expense to inspect each element, key element of the road, da-da-da-da-da.
As deemed necessary by the building commissioner.
Right.
You want to add that too?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay.
And do we need the engineer
under the
thing
supervision,
in there?
You know, like that point.
We talked about that earlier.
I don't think we need engineer, as long as it's an inspection service that has the appropriate certification.
Independence
inspection service.
Professionals or something?
Inspection service.
Independent inspection service?
Yeah.
Okay.
Right, like an allied testing on a Springfield or, you know, something like that. Mm-hmm. It's actually not that expensive.
If they have a list to go by.
Right.
Yeah,
and they
agree.
Do you want to carry over any of that subsequent language in 14 about the reasonable number of hours and so forth, or?
We're going to create a schedule of inspections. I think that's
The 6 already says there'll be a schedule.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So
yeah.
Then we can leave everything else out of 14? Just carry over the the independent inspection service provided to the town at applicant's expense, basically.
And Kip does make a good point. We're paying for this twice.
No,
I'm right. To do it.
And with, no.
But in no disrespect to our building inspector official, you know, he shouldn't be in charge of road building.
No.
Period. And I think maybe that's the other thing, as John's pointing out, that would help if, and Kip says, you know, I've got expertise here on the planning board, this could also. Do we want to put this also in?
It has it right there. So town of Deerfield.
Or the planning board.
Or representatives.
Town of Deerfield officials and or independent site inspection services.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah, it should be a third party, and it takes
No, but I mean, a point, in other words, the building commissioner, not just the building commissioner, but and
oh, I got what
or
you're
right. Right. Any town official. So it could be the highway super, it could be the police chief, it could be the water department folks.
Well, I'd like to get my little dig in here that recently, the town paid professional engineers over $500,000 from Boston to come to little town of Deerfield, but yet one member had to straighten them out and save the town a couple hundred thousand dollars because they used their professional knowledge to really pull the wool over the town's eyes.
So good thing we had that town official, and that same town official could do the same thing here, right?
Right.
So
that, I mean, that is
just because you pay a lot of money for these people doesn't mean.
And nobody's suggesting that we're paying a lot of money. We're just also saying that I'm not on your first clock right now, and I'm not coming back to check any of the wells. You know, that's not my job.
And one thing he doesn't need is every officer of the town pulling in there going, "No, you don't do it like that.
Right.
You do it like that." I mean,
so we talked about
before. There's specific rules and guidelines how things are inspected.
We do a inspection list. The building inspector says yes, I can. No, I can't. He says maybe this is the police department because it's the crosswalks, whatever. You know, so he puts that down and makes the determination who it is. And then if there are other ones that he feels has to be done independent, then bring in the independent, and we'll pay for it twice.
So that's what I added at the end. So it says that it would all be, the schedule would be determined by agreement with the Deerfield Planning Board prior to the endorsement of the definitive plan and as deemed necessary by the building commissioner.
Right.
So that gets that discretion. So everybody,
let's just disagree with that. That's
nothing required.
Yep. So are we striking 14?
So we've added that to 6, and then we're striking 14, correct?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Okay.
8.
Very good work here, gentlemen. 8 is my next, exactly. This is the 18-month time frame. I assume that was the reason why the hold was put on.
Yes, we've been stating that this is a substantial project, as we all know, and there are market variables and fluctuations in sales and things of that fashion that happen, and that we do want to build this in 3 phases. The road is the only way that makes sense to do something like this. So we want to be able to look at it. I'm looking at a time frame, as I've said in several meetings now, between 5 and 7 years for the build-out. I tell my bank 7 because you have to be conservative with banks to make sure the money's there. I anticipate somewhere, if sales continue the way they are, will be 5. There's already 21% of the units under deposit. So I think, which is pretty amazing for this process where we're at right now. So I think that the construction will continue or move along pretty quickly. But there's winter, you know, and slow down there, and market factors that come into play. So we would like to make sure that we have 5 to 7 years to complete this road and not be encumbered by 18 months.
For the road?
For the infrastructure and road, yeah.
Yeah, so this stormwater management, though, has to go up front.
Most of the stormwater management is being done in phase 1, and we're actually looking at whether it makes a fiscal sense to do the entire stormwater management in phase 1. But what we're doing, John, is making sure that any area that would be affected by impermeable surfaces, the stormwater is being put in at that time.
Yeah.
So that if phase 1 is put in and we sell out as quickly as I think we are, then we already have partial phase 2 done because we're bringing the water out and putting the gravel road or gravel strata there. So, yeah, I still think that we need to make sure that we're somewhere between 5 and 7 years on completion. It's the number I've given the board all the way through, and I think it's relatively realistic.
But 5 to 7 years for not for beyond phase one. So can we put, are we looking at a timeline for phase one? Is that
well,
what we're, is that
no.
What
so what we're, is? What we're, what they're doing.
And I'm looking at eight and saying, is that really not,
you're so we're talking not talking about having the houses built. We're talking about ways to stormwater the municipal hookups.
Yeah.
Correctly.
Yes.
So being able to make sure that the road is installed and that right. the infrastructure has been built. Phase one gets done. Let's say there's 32 units in phase one. If I can build, and this is aggressive, somewhere around 15 units a year, which is a lot. Mm-hmm. We're talking about 2 years minimum to get phase one built. And phase two is not quite as many units, but it's still substantial. I think it's somewhere around 28 units. So that we're looking at another 2 years, give or take. And then we have Greylock Lane to install, which will be phase three. And that's another year or two. So, you know, again, that brings us to 5 or 6 years. So if we say 5 to 7, because obviously the road is being built in those phases, so that it will be that time frame before the last piece of road is put in. And then again, most people, or all subdivisions I know of, don't want to put the final course on until the entire thing is complete.
I guess we just want help with this. The stormwater management system, we want, that's kind of the one we want to get on top
right,
of.
And you said that you're pretty much putting it all in.
We're putting it in, yeah. So I think we could word it in the fashion that the stormwater management will be put in any areas where impermeable surfaces are created.
Yeah.
So we're making sure that we're taking care of any additional waters created before it happens. Mm-hmm. Yes, I agree. And then the second phase of the road will take care of almost the entire rest of the stormwater management, and then there's a small amount left for Greylock Lane. So it will be, stormwater management will be done at the same time as the phase of the road. There we go.
Right, so.
That took me a minute.
Well, that's,
we got there,
business right here, we're helping you.
It's, that was great, yeah. So stormwater management will be installed for that phase of the road when the phase of the road is installed.
So Mr. Chairman, I was thinking maybe we could recommend here that, I mean, I don't know if we can go into all this infinite detail that has just been discussed, or we could change the time frame to something more reasonable agreed to, and then just add that it will be constructed according to a phased plan of construction agreed to by the planning board in advance of endorsement of the plan. Because it sounds like
fine.
You've got the phase plan ready, so just agree to that plan.
That sounds fine.
Right? And then and that gets so, but then this question is still, what do you feel is a reasonable time frame? You want to go for the 5 years, 7 years? I would choose a single. 5 to 7 years is an unenforceable range, you know?
Well, and can't we do it with check-in? We're not the bank. We're not pushing. We're pushing for some bumpers, but those can be moved. We're not, right?
Aren't well, you, we, could not put not a, you could not put a limit on it at all and just well, say you'll, it'll be constructed according to that phase plan that you'll...
Yeah, I mean, I don't...
How about putting time limits on each phase?
Yeah.
No, that'd be difficult, though, with sales. Difficult. But that, I like the idea that it's...
It's mutable.
It's...
So, or mutable, whatever. You know, you can change
point.
It.
Yeah.
But no, it's mutable, yes. So you're reviewing it. So we're saying, you know...
Unless extended in writing by the parties.
Does that make sense? So that you could actually put a, you could.
Again, I don't think the town cares if you
right.
ever finish the thing. We want to make sure though that the stormwater is
correct.
Is done at when
at
it
the
needs
time
to be done.
The road phase
yeah.
is constructed.
I think that's
so
kind of what we want to make.
No, and we do want it to be. I mean, we do that. His completion is in favor of all parties. We don't want a half finished project either. So part of this is. Putting, keeping the, just like the bank.
I'm not sure.
So what about this?
I'd say relevant, I guess. But what we care about is that things are done
that
at
is
the appropriate
at the same time.
Yeah.
So if we say subject to extension by, just to say, the ways stormwater management systems and municipal services shall be completed by phase to include said stormwater management for each phase. And that's it.
So... When you're doing phase one, does this mean that all the property for phase two and three will be untouched? That's my concern.
Yes.
That's
correct.
It will stay virgin until...
Well, what we're doing is we're removing the loam on phase three for obvious reasons. That's where the
right.
trucks and all will park, so we want to make sure we're not destroying that loam. That'll be piled. We're also, of course, phase two, we have to dig the water line because we don't want stagnant water. The water departments in our conversations have said they want that loop
right.
coming through. So phase two is being... started in a fashion, but not for construction of homes. So in other words, we're working on phase one, and at the same time we're building phase one, we'll put in the stormwater for that phase of the road, and then when we actually construct phase two, we put the stormwater in for that phase and so on to phase three. Is that?
Yeah, because I look at the language here, and I think that's, it's fair. It's a year and a half to put in the stormwater, and if it's not 100% in, the board can give you an extension, which I don't see an issue with, but if there is a problem, we can say, whoa, we got problems.
But you're talking for each phase, 18 months for each.
Because it says the ways, John, too. The ways, stormwater management system, and municipal services. You know, it's going to take me more than, it's going to take me
I get
2 years
I get
on phase
that.
One. Yeah.
Yeah, so for each phase, 18 yeah. months for each phase.
So if I may, Mr. Chairman.
So, 24 months. I mean, because I just don't feel comfortable putting out a five-year time.
All right, line. Right, exactly. So, all right.
It's a good point, and I'm thinking about, you know, we're having to think on the fly here, but I think that if you're saying 2 years.
2 years for each phase.
You know, I don't think there's any phase that's going to take us 2 years to construct. We're not talking about how fast before we go to the next phase. We're saying each phase will be constructed within 2 years.
Right, and then you could.
And if we need an extension, then we come to you guys and talk about it.
Yeah.
That works. We're good? Yeah, we're good with that.
And the first phase will be the biggest phase, and then second will be the next biggest, and third will be minor. Right. It's just really the road. But, yeah, we get you this. It's all, there's a narrative of the phase plus a color-coded that'll show you what our intention is.
I made him do it before the meetings. That's why he wants to get it.
So okay. What did we decide on the final
language? Yeah, so how do you want, how do we want this to read now?
So I would insert phase after, so subject to extension by the board for cause shown, the ways, stormwater management systems, and municipal services for each phase shall be completed within 24 months from the date of starting that phase.
Correct.
Okay.
And
according to the phase plan of construction, or you refer to the phases, so that's enough at that point.
You've got it.
Yeah, I know, but I'm saying what is in what we need to put in the language here.
Right, according to the phase plan.
Which would be agreed to in advance of endorsement of the plan.
Yeah.
Okay. All right, I think we've got it. So that one's set. Our next hold is down to 13C. If I might read, remember we had eliminated number 11 because that was duplicative.
And I think this one's just wording.
Yeah, this is the traffic detail.
Right. I mean, it says determined by the building inspector, and I think it'll be reasonable, but it does leave me open. It sounds like they're supposed to, like John Barona said, it sounds like they're supposed to be a police officer there all day long for every...
No.
I know that wasn't the intent.
And is it the building inspector or the police department?
That's a good question.
Because if it's a traffic issue, it's the police.
It is
the
police. I think it should be the police.
I think the state's going to really... the state is going to really control the work that's within Sugarloaf Street.
Well, that's. So. I don't think that's what they're talking about, though. They're talking about entering or exiting the site.
Right.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
I'm just thinking the day you do all the roads, there might be tons of trucks.
That's different.
You know, that's the day you need a police officer.
Yeah.
But most days...
When you're working in Sugarloaf Street, we have to by law.
Well, we're most likely I'll have details for making the utility connections, too.
Right. But
can't the phrase just whenever heavy construction vehicles are entering or exiting the site be removed, and then it would just read a traffic detail shall be provided on Sugarloaf Street as may be determined by the building inspector or police department upon consultation with the applicant or its representatives?
So what this was supposed to be,
right,
it's for work in Sugarloaf Street is what you're trying to protect against. Yeah.
People think that sounds good?
That sounds reasonable.
As maybe take out whenever every
problem section, and we'll add police department in addition to
addresses the concern. There.
Yep.
Great.
Okay. Done. Move on. Let's see. We've eliminated 14 and included the key portions of it in 6. We have a hold on 15, which is the contact. So we're back to that.
We definitely talked about signs and stuff. And
we talked about adding signage. Mm-hmm.
I think we got there, didn't we? We were talking about...
I didn't have specific language.
So
I have questions. So we need to come up with a specific language.
I'll paraphrase what I think we were getting to. A sign will be installed that meets the town's requirements for signage. A sign will be installed in front of the project stating... I wonder if we put it on a fence instead of putting it up on a post, if that gets us...
You could bypass the signage issue.
Well, not bypass it, but meet the requirements of it. I like that, Rachel. because there'll be other signage.
Oh, you don't like the bypass word.
So the sign will state that any questions and inquiries regarding the project, call this number. Any emergency issues or traffic, I don't know how you know, people parking on Sugarloaf Street, something.
Safety issues.
There you go. Yeah. Any safety issues regarding Sugarloaf Street, please call this number and be the 911 for the police.
Yeah.
And then the police will get the calls. If someone calls randomly here, then they'll be referred to the police.
Right.
And say, please call the police, and they'll determine if it's a discussion for them or directly to the developer.
Mm-hmm. I've seen signs before on sandwich boards in mm-hmm. cities.
That's a good idea.
Mm-hmm. Blank, blank, work zone. You add whatever company you want, and it gives the email address and telephone number for contacts.
But yeah.
That's a good idea. Yeah.
We got a sandwich board signage thing in our bylaws. Be careful.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So, on the fence. I'm just saying.
Very tender about the sandwich.
But it doesn't have to be on a sandwich board. It just,
sandwich board. Really on the ugly. Property behind the fence.
So, or the fence would be great.
Yeah. Yeah.
So applicant shall install signage consistent with town regulations to provide contact information for general questions.
General information.
For general information and for reporting of public safety issues.
Perfect.
So can we have another one that says the applicant will provide the town with emergency contact information for any time of the
yes.
day? I mean, I don't know if that's just a normal
thing. That's already thing included in the regulations, and they've already asserted they would do it. You can certainly put that in here.
No, so this is extra. This is,
All right, so you don't want to add that language? Right. You're satisfied that that's
well,
otherwise?
Well, I don't know where it is. I'd rather have it here because I don't know where else.
Okay, so applicant shall provide town.
Oh, I already know the chief of police, the board of selectmen, and the building inspector already have his contact.
With 24-hour emergency contact information.
Everybody does. It's here. Yeah, on file.
And if you want to pass that off to someone else, you just
correct.
Have to know.
Right, that's exactly.
All.
That's
yeah, which I would love to.
You want to go to, like, Italy. Everybody behind.
Actually.
You know, speaking
okay,
about working
with that
on
part of that same
Street,
condition,
right?
Just have two sentences as part of the same.
Yeah, I think it's all.
I just hope
contact information.
Okay. You take extra caution, you know, with the trucks leaving and going over that mm-hmm. sidewalk, and you know, maybe a stop sign at the side or something. I mean, that's.
Here's my feeling on it, John. Is if I do it right, I'm going to
well,
sell
yeah,
from a just look from a base perspective.
Right.
If I do it right, I'm selling more condos. If
right.
I do make a mess of this, then it's in the press and the rest, and it's a mess. We have to do it right.
Because there is going to be quite a few trucks.
There'll be quite a few trucks, especially
coming and going.
We're very fortunate, though, that we've found fantastic soils on site that are going to allow us to use a lot of that on site for the road construction. Mm-hmm. And minimize the amount of trucks that have to come in with soil. We have to bring gravel, of course, but a lot less.
Paving.
Pipes. Stop.
and Mr. Chairman, would you like to retain in that part about the public contact information on the sign that they should be available Monday through Friday during normal business
no,
hours?
Just
or you just want to leave that
sign
out?
Sign will just have contact information for the project.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So we'll leave out those details.
Yeah.
All right. I think we're good on 15. We're done with 14. We fixed 17. With all other qualified entities such
right.
as condo mm-hmm. association or management company and so forth, we're going to replicate that same language in 18.
Mm-hmm.
So I think those two are done. Any further comments on those? We eliminated 19.
Mm-hmm.
That's it, by my count.
Okay.
Ben.
Okay.
It's 2 hours.
I've always said I would walk through these meetings at 9 o'clock.
You are a trooper. You are a trooper. Thanks.
You talking about us?
Could you write that down somewhere? I
don't get a lot of that.
All right, I'm sorry. I'm just looking over
thinking.
A couple quick notes here over the past 4 months and make sure we didn't miss anything.
Can I ask, this is, we talked early on, first thing, do we want language at the beginning that addresses this issue of designated agent of the land or whatever you were saying before, Dan, so that that's clear in the, it's the applicant is not the property owner, but is the designated agent of the I know, you know, we talked about that later on down the whatever. I just wonder if that should be, I don't know. I think it should be somewhere, just so that there's clarity there.
We're just going to try to reference an email. I'm not sure I'm going to.
Okay. I mean, that all makes sense to me. I get it. The, you know, PNS.
If you look at the stormwater permit report, for example, and I also handed out to you a stormwater permit decision, which is another item that you need to vote on. Okay. But this lists the owners as well.
Right. Here.
This document for the certificate of decision this only one. Lists the applicant. We could add the owners here so that at least that information is present, and then the file for the project would show the purchase and sale agreement that had been filed and so forth. So that, that would give that much
so
more
it's
information.
It's not just here, because this is good. This is on record, but also here.
It's we could put that ownership well. Information right mm-hmm. on this certificate that's of decision as well, if you would like to have that. Would that make
like
you feel better?
More
okay,
transparent.
We'll do that, because we're adding the application date. This is, you know, you need to make this form work for you. So I think that
did
makes
you see that, Rachel?
Sense.
It's on.
Yeah.
So she has it listed there.
Yep, got it. I have two copies of that, actually.
So I will add owners here.
Why? I'm not sure why.
Why do I want that?
Yeah. Because those people aren't going to do the subdivision. We're doing a certificate of decision on definitive subdivision plan.
But we're granting it to an applicant who doesn't actually own the property.
Yeah. Own some
of it.
And I think Dan would corroborate. There's a form of ownership as because I have a purchase and sale on it.
And that's what I want to kind of yeah. get that there. Is that that's why I feel like he does as the agent of the land. I'm not asking. Yeah. I guess that maybe that's you don't necessarily need to list the owners, but list. I don't know. It just seems to me more transparent. More clear.
I want to make sure that one of the other landowners, this
right.
this decision doesn't go to them.
Yeah. Okay. No, I agree. I agree.
You know, all of a sudden they like throw you out. And then they,
so
you know,
it's like the LLC.
The form that I used did not have them listed there, which is why it isn't there, but it is on yeah. the other.
That's a good point, actually.
Well, that's all I'm saying. It's going with the applicant. So it yeah. could be referenced, but as we know, it is.
We already have enough confusion as to what the name of the applicant is to begin with, right? He's got a long line of names there.
They're listed all kinds of.
Is he got?
Well.
So I guess what you're saying is do it like that cover page, I guess.
You do want to add the owners.
Well.
And
or,
you know, do you want to add the deed references and all of that?
No. Or well.
Deeds are they
I don't know.
That's all listed on the permit report, and
you do have assessor's maps.
Yes. So that adds information as to location as well.
Mm. We'll say it again. I just
do
think.
Do you want to add the owners or not? I don't.
So
think
what's the downside? What's the downside?
Yeah, there is no downside.
There's no downside.
It goes right. a little longer on the back of the page.
Yeah.
All right.
No
so
downside.
So right after applicant, have
letter. Applicant. Yeah.
Okay.
That's we'll how do. I feel
and
like
then
it there's
has
no
location.
Downside.
Yeah. Fine.
Okay.
More paper.
Yes,
it's not really giving the.
It's we're already halfway down that page, so you have that.
I think the concern for Pat was that, John was, am I are you giving approval to the Gritz sisters as well as me, you know, in other words, and they go. Oh, we got approval here. We'll just get rid
no,
of it.
No, I think
well,
it's
that's why.
For the applicant.
No,
that's why
so
I
either.
Feel it's the applicant, and yeah. I feel like when you make a distinction between the applicant and the owners,
correct.
that actually makes to
that's
me
fine
feels
me.
Comfortable because you're doing the work. You're going.
Right.
You are the
everything
I like
states
this,
is the
designated
applicant.
Agent of the land.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
This was right. and everything that as we said going through, we wrote it as the applicant
right.
will do
mm-hmm.
this. So
mm-hmm.
I think
fine.
That's consistent.
In my query to town council, they said the Deerfield subdivision regs define an applicant as the owner or its duly authorized representative, and therefore having a purchase and sale. If a purchase and sale agreement serves as the basis for the applicant's interest in the site, the board may ensure that the PNS allows for the designee to take title. So Mr. Whiteman's listed in the purchase and sale as the
mm-hmm.
purchaser. So.
Mm-hmm.
So what was the term that you used there, though?
Designated agent of the land. Designated agent.
Wasn't designated applicant or something else.
Yeah. S&E or.
What is it?
Designee, S&E, but it's all the same.
Okay,
fine.
Same thing, applicant. Yep. We don't have a problem with that.
Thank you.
All right, so then, actually, the last
just the last couple of items.
I think we're down to this.
Yeah, we're down to the bitter end. So the last two items, one of which is actually they're sort of duplicative, but they're important reminders. Mm-hmm. The decision is subject to appeal in accordance with Mass General Laws Chapter 41, Section 81BB, within 20 days after the decision is filed with the Deerfield Town Clerk. And this approval is subject to the applicant providing an adequate performance guarantee to ensure the construction of ways and installation of municipal services for the subdivision. Failure to provide such performance guarantee may result in rescission of approval.
Just, I could ask my attorney this. Is it 20 business days or 20 calendar days?
I believe it's calendar.
Wow, really
Dan
quiet.
Could correct me if I'm wrong.
There's certain things that are business days and certain things that are
I believe this
days.
One's calendar, but we can double check for you. And then it just the back page is the signature lines.
So any more deliberations among the board?
No, I think we've had, like, to me anyways.
Good.
So
I need to move to approve the whole certificate of decision.
Do we get to see it one more time? Mm-hmm. Are we moving to approve something that you don't see?
So, you can wait. What was the language that we had about? Because once we make all these corrections,
endorsement happens on the plan.
Okay.
Right. So, if you want to see these corrections before you have your vote, mm-hmm. final vote, we can do that, but then it would have to go out to another meeting because, like, you know, we can't make them here. We've read them back. Right. Certainly, you know, have. I'm never going to tell you you shouldn't see anything before you voted. You know
personally,
me.
I would like to see the completed
final. Okay, so everybody would, and the applicant and their counsel might like to see those as well, so they can ensure that the wordsmithing meets their requirements. So
we don't feel it the same way. We feel as though that there's enough, I think we're working very well together, and I think that I'm not concerned that we're not, I don't believe that we're going to come up with a head wall on any one of these items. And hold on one second.
No, we'd just like to see it, obviously.
I
think
I appreciate that, though, Mark. I think that shows
anyway,
good.
They're
we represent
what
people.
I'm saying is they can vote on the definitive approval now, contingent upon us. So what we've done, what has been done in the past is you're voting on a definitive plan approval contingent upon the conditions and information that is going to be discussed and agreed upon between the other factions, you know, all the ones that we've gone through.
Well, I think you're right in regard to your phase construction plan and your inspection schedule and maintenance agreements and all of those things will happen prior to the endorsement of the plan. But I would not have you vote your actual decision conditionally on finishing these conditions. I think they when they vote them, they're final. And I think we did. I have a very messy copy.
Right.
I don't know what yours looks
mine
like.
Messy.
But
yeah,
I think it's good caution and good practice on your part.
Today it would be what we let's
whatever.
We vote on what we talked about, and
right.
I just don't feel comfortable doing that.
So I'd be happy to turn this right around and have it
the waivers.
You know, ready for you to have your final vote then in you know, in 2 weeks at your next meeting if that works.
That 20 days?
The 20 days is after you file this with the town clerk. Oh. So you finish it, you sign it over to her, she logs it in, and then your 20 days starts tolling.
When's the town meeting? That's not the
moment.
Next Monday, 24.
So, I mean, we could even do it.
Next week.
You want to meet for a half hour prior to?
I'm fine with that.
Yeah, we could do that.
I'm fine with that. It you know, he's...
I'm good with that.
Very patient.
Yeah, yeah.
Is
that good for you? But we don't need you. We can have a quorum without you if you're okay with it.
What's next Monday, John?
Sorry.
That's the town meeting, the 24th.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Otherwise, the next Monday is May 1st, our normal meeting.
No, that's when's the election day.
Yeah, we can.
Isn't that later? It's May 1st.
Yeah.
We can do it next Monday.
I'm okay with next Monday.
Sure.
Sure.
6 o'clock?
That's fine.
Quick, we're not here till 10.
We can't be long because both of us are going to need to be somewhere else. We're going to have to meet.
Right. So I think there's no more deliberation. It's a matter of
Hearing the draft, making any final.
This stuff can be emailed out to all.
I'll do it tomorrow and send it out to everybody here. If that's.
We can all review it. It's just a matter of seeing it before. I don't feel comfortable.
I agree. So what we're discussing is that, excuse me.
Any of the due diligence that we're talking about, the construction schedule and things, we're not supposed to produce those by next
no.
meeting.
No.
We're just talking about the conditions we agreed upon.
Right. That's great. It's not a problem. We're on the same page.
I'm ready with that phase. I'm ready with that.
You know, could you guys just take a copy of the phase and make him happy?
I'd love to see a copy of it, Tony. You can send it to me.
Got his color printer going and everything.
Have you got the copy to hand out tonight, Tony?
Oh, my.
That's all done. All right, so
I'm going to go get my calendar. If you
we don't need a continuation or a vote. We're just going to
no.
Let's have a vote that
we're going to meet again.
We're going to meet
on the 24th,
April 24th, 6 o'clock at Frontier Regional High
School. 6 o'clock. Can somebody remind me that it's 6 o'clock?
424 Frontier High School, 6 o'clock.
Is there going to be a room that we can use there?
We just sat in front of the all ones.
We did that.
I don't think it matters.
6 o'clock?
That way Kip's 6 p.m. Ready.
There's plenty of time to advertise a meeting, right?
You have to do the 48
hours. 48 hours for that. Okay, not 2 weeks.
I mean, so deep now. I might as well come to make sure it's
but we need to make sure that Priscilla gets the work.
Right. She has to do it, yeah.
So they're talking about Frontier, so we're just discussing.
We did it in the front of the Frontier gym. I mean, like.
Select board's an email, so be in touch with Pat. She's in touch with the school as we're making more arrangements.
Great.
Okay.
So you're going to just let us know where. It'll be the 24th at 6, then a place
somewhere at Frontier, the notice will have a specific date.
Okay.
Or location, a specific room. Yeah.
Mr. Price's room.
Which doesn't exist anymore.
Okay. And I'll work on this stuff tomorrow.
What about the stormwater?
Yes.
A little storm.
Thank you.
Remember where you used to sleep?
Mr. Chairman, while we're talking about that.
I think we might have a
We have also the stormwater permit decision. I don't know if you want to proceed with that tonight or also put that off until that next meeting.
We just do it now. It's all set.
Draft dated 4/18/17, the stormwater. Wait, is this the permit report? Is that what it is?
Yep.
And then the
stormwater permit decision. My report is just mine to you. Yes. Yeah. So this is the stormwater permit decision is the one, and that's it's a 4/12. There were no changes that were submitted by anyone. It's very straightforward. All the details in the key documents. I added a single finding because this did not originally have findings, but. New Town Council reminded us that it's very important for the public record and in the case of any appeal to establish findings. So that is on the middle of page 5. And then the conditions are fairly straightforward and proceed from the bottom of page 5 through 6. You want me to read through those conditions like we did the last, or you want to just let people have a moment?
Let's take a moment. I think these are all...
Pat, you stated this hasn't changed, right?
No, but as I'm looking at it myself, I see I had copied them over from the other plan. So, for example, number 4, we've made a change to the language in the certificate of decision that we probably want to reflect back here.
That's right. Yeah.
And want them to match.
So basically, you send these out, and we could make the signatures next Monday. All at the same time, right? And there's no advantage to doing this tonight without, and we could do it next Monday night after everything is completed.
Right, if you wanted to do that. But let's take a look at it and see, you know, like, so
yep.
Let's go through this, because actually for the TV audience and other people should know what we're looking at. So the first one is just that we have an application.
It's applicants shall construct the condominium, so we're looking at the condition. So it's the same one. They shall construct according to the plan.
Plan dated March 22nd.
March 22, yeah. 2017.
Second one is about the performance guarantees that we've talked about.
Right.
Third
and
one
I
is
don't
about,
think we changed either of those, so I think those are okay.
Yeah. Third one is about the plan phases for construction. so that, that the applicant does have to provide us with those details. The fourth one is the applicant will provide the opportunity for down at Deerfield representatives to inspect key elements. So we're going to use the same wording.
We did make changes to that, so we would transfer that same wording over.
Fifth one, within 60 days of completion of each phase of the construction, applicant shall submit as-built drawings. Did we make a change on that, or we didn't?
I think we left that one exactly the same.
That's good. Then 6, 7, 8 is about operation and maintenance plan and agreement. I don't think we made any changes there. Road utility easement. And then again, so 8 is also then going to change a little.
Yeah, so 8 again.
Town of Deerfield and its representatives.
That will change, so those are included in the one.
And then the ninth one is their certificate of completion.
Which is a requirement of the code, so.
All right, yeah, so there's just a few wording changes in 2 or 3 of those, and then we'll sign.
So we'll do both of these and send them out, and you can vote them both then next Monday. Okay?
Anything else from the planning board?
I'll give this to them, then they'll have answers on what's going on.
Do we need to vote that meeting or just set it?
Getting rid of this tonight.
There you go, we just set meetings.
Please take one of these.
Thank you, we'll see you next Monday.
Would you please take one of these from him?
I would love one.
We want one of them.
It's beautiful.
It's killing me.
So colorful.
Wow.
Yeah, ooh and ah, please, ooh and ah.
Did you hear yourself, Tony?
Not me.
Yeah, they could have used this a long time ago. I just did a project.
Thanks, John, for the chance to talk.
So I would just before we go on to the next item, I just want to highlight that the planning board has had 4 public hearings and extensive deliberations, and I appreciate all of the questions and all the thought everybody's put into it from the planning board.
Well, this woman over here, she said something earlier, but I didn't quite hear it.
What you said? I said a public hearing. You don't need to have that.
Oh, yeah. This is really great.
Did you get her name, John?
That's the first time I've ever heard it.
Christmas card.
But I'm not
here
until next Monday because I think this is a done deal.
Ooh.
Mark.
So it's off the record, but she said we were terrific.
Do you think you could change the layout? I want to know if it looks like a Superman one.
Good night.
Good night, gentlemen.
Sometimes I.
Where did our agenda go? Damn.
It was close.
That's right.
All right. Can we go home?
No, we need to sign decision paperwork for Cumberland Farms and New England Patient Network, which.
Does Pat have those?
I sent them in 2 meetings ago after you guys did them. The first of them you had actually signed that night, so there was a signature page that I had sent the completed report to be attached to, and apparently that has not happened. And then the NEP, so I think that was the Cumberland Farms, and then the New England Patient Network was the next one. And so
I have items to sign. Let's get down to these first.
That one had been sent back and has been available for signature now since after a couple meetings ago.
All right.
I got it.
Okay. Signed decision paperwork for Cumberland Farms in New England. So we have a final report. So the decision was March 8th for the Cumberland Farms. It was a site plan review and stormwater permit decision. And we approved that on March 6th, so we just needed this paperwork to sign. What's the difference here? Oh, the same like here, there's the report. That is just the report, and then the decision's in front of it. So there's a specific place for the chair and clerk, and then anybody else.
I had a vice chair. I realized I only had places for chair and clerk, and left the vice chair. I apologize. Okay. I added that.
And then this one.
You want us to sign this report too?
No,
the report doesn't need to sign.
And it doesn't need to be appended to it either.
It's helpful.
She's just being
And again, this was March 17th, New England Patient Network.
So this just has to be signed by the people here tonight.
Who else?
Planning board.
We're missing.
Yep. March 6th.
Roger and
just those two, right?
Yeah. Okay.
Are you up for Rachel?
And what is that? What form again? We just signed.
No.
What do you call it?
That was the site plan for Cumberland Farms. Site plan and stormwater.
All your money.
Site plan and storm.
And then this one is the New England Patient Network.
I'll sign this one. Not signing anything that has to do with the narcotics trade.
Didn't require stormwater.
Yeah, that was just site plan review, as I recall.
Site plan.
All right, then we want to authorize disbursement of some encumbered funds. And is that your one, or is that a different one?
I don't know exactly what that
is. Would you pass this back to John, please?
There, it may relate to, there were some peer review funds that were due back to Eagle Brook School. When they pulled that application, that may relate to that. And then I did have an item that I wanted to bring to the board.
All right, so I'm signing, I'm approving, I'm signing payment of our consulting civil engineer, which was paid for by this applicant, by the advertisements that were put in the paper. And then the Council of Governments, we owe some money to, and do you want to speak to that?
I understand from the town administrator that all outstanding bills have been paid as of today. So we're good on that.
Oh, good. And we have used many hours, more hours than we had anticipated, so we're going to do another contract.
Well,
with
so given how busy you guys have been,
yes,
and the many days and nights that we've been working on all these projects.
So we get a bonus, huh?
We have, I was beginning to work on my quarterly billing, and it became clear that we will need to do an extension of this fiscal year contract because we're up against the $15,000 total, which includes some town funds and some applicant funds. So in order to proceed, we'll need to do an amendment to the contract to allow for charges
of,
above and beyond that $15,000 allowance.
I'll put my name
currently
on it.
I have a draft amendment for you to review, which is based on previous similar amendments that we did. I have not completed all of the accounting on that bill and on the peer review bills. I believe I will be over on both accounts, so that I will need to submit a letter to ask for additional funds to complete this portion of the peer review. And then if you want me to continue to help you as we move into the phase where we go with the performance bonding and the construction phasing and all that, I'll need to present you with an estimate for how much time that would take.
Do we need to vote on extending into the next fiscal year?
We will sign as of in June, then we'll be signing another contract for the new fiscal year, but this is to get us to the end of June.
But so we have a contract with them, but this does not mean that it's the town of Deerfield's money. A lot of this is coming from the applicant.
A lot of it is coming from the applicant.
So it's two different.
Although there was additional work that I did on behalf of the board reviewing projects that were not applicant based. So for example, the New England Patient Network was straight out of the technical assistance contract. So that applies to that portion of it. So it's a complicated bill. I only just had the chance to start on it at the end of last week. So we'll be working on that, but realized that we needed to work through this amendment. It is signed by the select board, but I wanted you to see it and hopefully approve it on our behalf so that we can continue to finish this work up.
Do we need to vote on it, you mean, or just to say okay?
I think it would be nice if you had a vote. I think that would make it more official for the Board of Selectmen.
So okay. I move that we concur. What do we do? We are endorsing. Do we endorse this, or we support the?
She's doing it.
Yeah.
What did I just had? Not support before that. Endorse this.
Approve this bill for the select.
It's not a bill.
It's an amendment to the agreement.
It's an amendment
for
to
services.
Your agreement.
Okay, so.
So we endorse this amendment for the agreement to PRCOG to continue the work that we are doing currently.
Providing
under a current contract.
Under a current contract.
Amendments or contracts.
to see us through to the end of this fiscal year.
The agreement right. for services.
Amended agreement.
So we're amending.
Amendment to the agreement for services.
Amendment to the agreement.
I'll second that.
For services. Okay, John.
John B.
Madam.
Sir, yes.
It says it's outlined in a letter to the planning board from the FERCOG dated
yes.
April 20th.
That is yet to come. As you can see, April 20th is yet to be here. I didn't have time to do it for today. I haven't completed all of the paperwork. So I wanted that in here so that when it does get submitted to the Board of Selectmen.
We've been here so long, it's already April 20th.
I needed to find out from you before I could complete that letter what you want me to do. If you want me to just finish this piece, or if you want me to add in also this intermediate piece where I'd be helping with the phasing and the performance bonding.
But this language isn't changing.
No, this
was written in such a way. But I need, but to do that letter, I had to know that information.
Is this the complete motion? Rachel moved and John B. seconded a motion to endorse the amendment to the agreement for services.
On the draft copy submitted to us on at our meeting on April 18th.
You want to put that in here on the draft?
Dated.
Dated.
It's not really dated at this point because that goes on when it gets signed, but it's effective March 1, 2016, if you want to put that.
Okay. If the draft copy effective.
March 1st.
March 1st, 2017.
Yeah.
Okay. All those in favor? Aye. Aye. Opposed? Zero. Abstain?
They go in there now.
5-0-0.
Thank you very much, gentlemen and ladies.
Two quick
Thank
other
you.
Things here. I need a vote to refund. So the Eagle Brook project that was withdrawn, we need to return $1,751.96 to them.
Okay. 1,000 what?
751 mm-hmm. and 96 cents.
I'd like to make a motion to refund Eagle Brook the 1,700 and
5196
or 7.
I'll second the motion.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Abstain? Actually, it's 1,751.96 plus interest.
Plus interest.
Apparently, we
interest is required by statute.
We are very diligent.
What is it? 0.0005.
It's not going to be a lot, but.
But I abstain.
And it's right to Eagle Brook School.
Oh, and
one abstention.
Is that the right name? Eagle Brook School is going to go back to.
Make sure you have Rachel down as an abstention.
Oh, so that's going to be 4-0-1.
No.
Because she recused herself.
4-0-1.
I'm not here.
It's still.
And then one last thing, there's an A&R, this A&R was endorsed by the planning board on May 26, 2015. Somehow the Mylar got lost. In order to get it registered, a new Mylar needs to be signed. If you could be so kind as to do that, it would be much appreciated. Priscilla, this is for 121 San Gully Road, is it? Yeah. So we should date it 5/26/15.
No.
Do you have minutes of a meeting saying that you voted and endorsed it?
I'm not.
I would just want to confirm.
Yeah, I wouldn't just go sign.
Put that off then to the.
Just put today's date.
Yeah, it doesn't matter to them.
You don't backdate it.
Yeah, but I mean, we would have signed more than just a Mylar, or there are other copies that with our signatures on them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's
there
what I'm.
Should be one in the file somewhere in this office.
It's a little bit shady to me.
I just want a copy of the Mylar.
But you need to confirm that it was in fact a signed plan to begin with.
Yeah. I mean, who researched it? What did they find?
I remember it. It's not that big.
There should be signed regular copies somewhere. If we can see that.
You guys keep copies in your building commissioner files and your,
Yeah.
It's kind of being a stickler, but as I was looking at your face, John, I could see.
Well, I hate to backdate 2 years, but then I hate if I put it today's date, is that going to hurt anybody?
Yeah. No.
I don't think so. It's legit. It's like they're saying.
When you signed it.
Well, if something happened legally in that intervening number of years,
and what if they find
would be
the
affected
other,
if
what if
the
they find
date
the
were
other,
now?
What if they find the Mylar?
So what?
Well, then it wouldn't matter.
Is this the same?
The same.
Is this the same one we signed, or has this got something?
Well, that's why I'm saying, and there should be a regular.
We're going to meet next week, so we'll do it.
There should be a regular paper copy somewhere that
should be something
right,
to confirm that it was actually
signed. Because we signed the Mylar plus.
Is there any other business before the board?
No, I make a motion to adjourn.
I second it.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.